from the collected works of John Owen, Volume 7, A Treatise of the Dominion of Sin and Grace. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. Romans 7:14, Chapter 1. What sin is consistent with a state of grace, and what is not. Sin's great design and all to obtain dominion. It has it in unbelievers and contends for it in believers, the way by which it acts. The psalmist, treating with God in prayer about sin, acknowledges that there are in all men unsearchable errors of life, beyond all human understanding or comprehension, with such daily sins of infirmity as stand in need of continual cleansing and pardon. Psalm 19:12. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. But yet he supposes that these things are consistent with a state of grace and acceptation with God. He had no thought of any absolute perfection in this life, of any such condition that should not stand in need of continual cleansing and pardon. Therefore, there are or may be such sins in believers, yes, many of them which yet under a due application to God for purifying and pardoning grace, shall neither deprive us of peace here, nor endanger our salvation hereafter. But he speaks immediately of another sort of sins, which partly from their nature, or what they are in themselves, and partly from their operation and power, will certainly prove destructive to the souls of men in which they are. Verse 13. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. This is the hinge whereon the whole cause and state of my soul turns. Although I am subject to many sins of various sorts, yet under them all I can and do maintain my integrity and covenant uprightness in walking with God, and where I fail, am kept within the reach of cleansing and pardoning mercy continually administered to my soul by Jesus Christ. But there is a state of life in this world in which sin has dominion over the soul, acting itself presumptuously, in which integrity and freedom from condemning guilt are inconsistent. This state, therefore, which alone is eternally ruinous to the souls of men, he deprecates with all earnestness, praying to be kept and preserved from it. What he there so earnestly prays for, the apostle in the words of the text promises to all believers by virtue of the grace of Christ Jesus administered in the gospel, both the prayer of the prophet for himself, and the promise of the apostle in the name of God to us, do manifest of how great importance this matter is, as we shall declare it to be immediately. There are some things supposed or included in these words of the apostle. There we must first a little inquire into, without which we cannot well understand the truth itself proposed in them as, number one, it is supposed that sin does still abide in and dwell with believers, for so is the meaning of the words, that sin which is in you shall not have dominion over you. That is, none of them who are not sensible of it, who groan not to be delivered from it, as the apostle does, Romans 7:24. Those who are otherwise minded know neither themselves nor what sin is, nor wherein the grace of the gospel consists. There is a flesh remaining in every one which lusteth against the Spirit, Galatians 5:17. And it adheres to all the faculties of our souls, in which it is called the old man, Romans 6:6, in opposition to the renovation of our minds and all the faculties of them, called the new man, Ephesians 4:24, or new creature in us, Romans 8:14, a continual working and provision to fulfill its own lusts, so that it abides in us in the way of a dying, decaying habit, weakened and impaired, but acting itself in inclinations, motions, and desires suitable to its nature. All scripture and experience concur herein, so a supposition of it is the only ground of the whole doctrine of evangelical mortification. That this is a duty incumbent on believers all the days of their lives, such a duty as without which they can never perform any other in a new manner, will not be denied by any, but either such as are wholly under the power of atheistical blindness, or such as by the fever of spiritual pride have lost the understanding of their own miserable condition, and so lie dreaming about absolute perfection. With neither sort are we at present concerned. Now the first proper object of this mortification is this sin that dwells in us. It is the flesh which is to be mortified, the old man which is to be crucified, the lusts of the flesh with all their corrupt inclinations, actings, and motions that are to be destroyed, Colossians 3:5, Romans 6:6, Galatians 5:24. Unless this be well fixed in the mind, we cannot understand the greatness of the grace and privilege here expressed. Number two, it is supposed that this sin, which, in the remainders of it, so abides in believers in various degrees, may put forth its power in them to obtain victory and dominion over them. It is first supposed that it has this dominion in some, that it doth bear rule over all unbelievers, all that are under the law, and then that it will strive to do the same in them that believe and are under grace. For affirming that it shall not have dominion over us, he grants that it may or does contend for it. Only it shall not have success, it shall not prevail. Hence it is said to fight in war in us, Romans 7:23, and to war against our souls, 1 Peter 2:11. Now, it thus fights and wars and contends in us for dominion, for that is the end of all war, whatever fights, it doth it for power and rule. This, therefore, is the general design of sin and all its actings. These actings are various according to the variety of lusts in the minds of men, but its general design in them all is dominion. Where anyone is tempted and seduced of his own lusts, as the Apostle James speaks, be it in a matter never so small or so unusual, the temptation whereunto may never occur again, the design of sin lies not in the particular temptation, but to make it a means to obtain dominion over the soul. And the consideration of this should keep believers always on their guard against all the motions of sin, though the manner of them seem but small, and the occasions of them seem such as are not like to return. For the aim and tendency of every one of them is dominion and death, which they will compass if not stopped in their progress, as the Apostle there declares in James 1:14 and 15. Believe not its flatteries. Is it not a little one? This is the first, or shall be the last time. It requires only little place in the mind and affections. It shall go no further. Give not place to its urgency and solicitations. Admit of none of its excuses or promises. It is power over your souls to their ruin, and it aims at it in all. Number three, there are two ways in which, in general, sin acts its power and aims at the obtaining this dominion, and they are the two only ways in which any may design or attain an unjust dominion, and they are deceit and force, both of which I have fully described in another discourse on indwelling sin, with respect whereunto it is promised that the Lord Christ shall deliver the souls of the poor that cry unto him from deceit and violence, Psalm 72:12-14. These are the only two ways of obtaining an unjust dominion, and where they are in conjunction, they must have a mighty prevalency, and such as will render the contest hazardous. There are few believers but have found it so, at least in their own apprehensions. They have been ready to say at one time or another, we shall one day fall into the hand of this enemy, and have been forced to cry out to Jesus Christ for help and succor, with no less vehemency than the disciples did at sea when the ship was covered with waves. Lord, save us, we perish. Matthew 8:24-26. And so they would do did he not come in seasonably to their succor. Hebrews 2:18. And herein the soul hath frequently no less experience of the power of Christ and his grace than the disciples on the outcry had of his sovereign authority when he rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. This dominion of sin is that which we have here security given us against, though it will abide in us, though it will contend for rule by deceit and force, yet it shall not prevail, it shall not have the dominion. And this is a case of the highest importance unto us. Our souls are and must be under the rule of some principle or law. And from this rule, our state is determined and denominated. We are either servants of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness, Romans 6:16. This is the substance of the discourse of the apostle in that whole chapter, namely the state of the soul is unto life and death eternal, follows the conduct and rule that we are under. If sin have the dominion, we are lost forever. If it be dethroned, we are safe. It may tempt, seduce, and entice. It may fight, war, perplex, and disquiet. It may surprise into actual sin. Yet if it have not the dominion in us, we are in a state of grace and acceptation with God. Of the dominion of sin and grace, chapter 2, nature of the dominion of sin. The inquiries for understanding the text proposed, the first spoken to, namely, what is the dominion of sin which we are freed from and discharged of by grace? We shall inquire into three things from the words of this text. Number one, what is that dominion of sin which we are freed from and discharged of by grace? Number two, how may we know whether sin has the dominion in us or not? Number three, what is the reason and evidence of the assurance here given us that sin shall not have dominion over us, namely, because we are not under the law, but under grace? Number one, as to the first of these, I shall only recount some such properties of it as will discover its nature in general. The particulars wherein it doth consist will be considered afterward. First, the dominion of sin is perverse and evil, and that on both the accounts which render any rule or dominion so to be. For number one, it is usurped. Sin has no right to rule in the souls of men. Men have no power to give sin a right to rule over them. They may voluntarily enslave themselves to it, but this gives sin no right or title. All men have originally another Lord to whom they owe all obedience, nor can anything discharge them from their allegiance thereunto, and this is the law of God. The apostle says, indeed, that to whom men yield themselves servants to obey, his servants they are to whom they obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness, Romans 6:16. And so it is. Men are by this a proper servants of sin. They become so by their own voluntary subjection to it. But this gives sin no title against the law of God, whose right alone it is to bear sway in the souls of men. For all that give themselves up to the service of sin do live in actual rebellion against their natural liege lord. Hence, a number of things do follow. Number one, the great aggravation of the evil of a state of sin. Men who live in it do voluntarily wrest themselves, what lies in them, from under the rule of the law of God, and give up themselves to be slaves to this tyrant. Could it lay any claim to this dominion, had it any title to plead, it were some alleviation of guilt in them that give up themselves to it. But men yield themselves to the slavery of sin, as the apostle speaks. They reject the rule of God's law and choose this foreign yoke, which cannot but be an aggravation of their sin and misery. Yet so it is that the greatest part of men do visibly and openly profess themselves the servants and slaves of sin. They wear its livery and do all its drudgery. Yea, they boast themselves in their bondage, and never think themselves so brave and gallant as when by profane swearing, drunkenness, uncleanness, covetousness, and scoffing at religion, they openly avow the Lord whom they serve, the Master whom they do belong. But their damnation does not slumber, whatever they may dream in the meantime. Number two. Hence it follows that ordinarily all men have a right in themselves to cast off the rule of sin and to vindicate themselves to liberty. They may, when they will, plead the right and title of the law of God to the rule of their souls, to the utter exclusion of all pleas and pretenses of sin for its power. They have right to say to it, "Get thee hence, what have I to do any more with idols?" All men, I say, have this right in themselves because of the natural allegiance they owe to the law of God, but they have not power of themselves to execute this right and actually to cast off the yoke of sin. But this is a work of grace. Sin's dominion is broken only by grace. But you will say then, to what end serves this right if they have not power in themselves to put it in execution? And how can it be charged as an aggravation of their sins that they do not use a right which they have, seeing they have no power so to do? Will you blame a man that has a right to an estate if he do not recover it when he hath no means so to do? I answer briefly three things. First, no man living neglects the use of this right to cast off the yoke and dominion of sin, because he cannot of himself make use of it, but merely because he will not. He does voluntarily choose to continue under the power of sin, and looks on everything as his enemy that would deliver him. The carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject unto the law of God, neither indeed can be. Romans 8:7. When the law comes at any time to claim its right and rule over the soul, a man under the power of sin looks on it as his enemy that comes to disturb his peace and fortifies his mind against it. And when the gospel comes and tenders a way and means for the soul's delivery, offering its aid and assistance to that end, this also is looked on as an enemy and is rejected, and all its offers to that end. See Proverbs 1:24-31 and John 3:19. This sin is the condition of everyone that abides under the dominion of sin. He chooses so to do. He continues in that state by an act of his own will. He avows an enmity to everything which would give him deliverance, which will be a sore aggravation of his condemnation at the last day. But secondly, God may justly require that of any which it is in the power of the grace of the gospel to enable them to perform and comply with, for this is tendered to them in the preaching of it every day. And although we know not the ways and means of its effectual communication of grace to the souls of men, yet this is certain, that grace is so tendered in the preaching of the gospel that none go without it. None are destitute of its aids and assistances, but those alone who by a free act of their own wills do refuse and reject it. This is that which the whole cause depends on. You will not come to me that you might have life. And this all unbelievers have or may have experience of in themselves. They may know on a due examination of themselves that they do voluntarily refuse the assistance of grace which is offered for their deliverance, therefore is their destruction of themselves. But thirdly, there is a time when men lose even the right also. He who gave himself to have his ear bored lost all his claim to future liberty. He was not to go out at the year of Jubilee. So there is a time when God judicially gives up men to the rule of sin, to abide under it forever, so as that they lose all right to liberty. So he dealt with many of the idolatrous Gentiles of old, in Romans 1:24, 26, and 28. And so he continues to deal with the like profligate sinners. So he acts towards the generality of the anti-Christian world, 2 Thessalonians 2:11-12, and with many despisers of the gospel, Isaiah 6:9-10. When it has come to this, men are cast at law and have lost all right entitled to liberty from the dominion of sin. They may repine sometimes at the service of sin or the consequence of it in shame and pain, and the shameful distempers that will pursue many in their uncleanness, yet God having given them up judicially to sin, they have not so much as a right to put up one prayer or petition for deliverance, nor will they do so, but are bound in the fetters of cursed presumption or despair. See their work and wages, Romans 2:5-6. This is the most woeful state and condition of sinners in this world, an unavoidable entrance into the chambers of death. You that have lived long under the power of sin, beware lest that come upon you which is spoken of in these scriptures. You have as yet a right unto deliverance from the bondage and servitude in which you are, if you put in your claim in the court of heaven. You don't know how soon you may be deprived of this also by God's giving you up judicially to sin and Satan. Then all complaints will be too late, and all springs of endeavors for relief will be utterly dried up. All your reserves for a future repentance shall be cut off, and all your cries shall be despised. Proverbs 1:24-31. While it is yet called today, harden not your hearts, lest God swear in his wrath, that ye shall never enter into his rest. That you may be warned, take notice of the signs or symptoms of the approach of such a season, of such an irrecoverable condition are, first, a long continuance in the practice of any known sin. There are bounds to divine patience. The long-suffering of God for a time waits for repentance, 1 Peter 3:20, 2 Peter 3:9. But there is a time when it doth only endure vessels of wrath, fitted to destruction, Romans 9:22, which is commonly after a long continuance in known sin. Secondly, when convictions have been digested and warnings despised. God doth not usually deal thus with men until they have rejected the means of their deliverance. There is a generation, indeed, who, from their youth up, do live in a contempt of God. Such are those proud sinners whom the psalmist describes in Psalm 10:2-7, and so on. There are seldom any tokens of the going forth of the decree against this sort of men. The appearing evidences of it are, as they're adding drunkenness to thirst, one kind of sin unto another, making a visible progress in sinning, adding boasting and a profane contempt of all things sacred to their course and sin. But ordinarily, those that are in danger of this judicial hardness have had warnings and convictions which made some impressions on them, but are now left without any calls and rebukes, or at least any sense of them. Thirdly, when men contract the guilt of such sins as seem to entrench on the unpardonable sin against the Holy Ghost, such as proud, contemptuous, malicious reproaches of the ways of God, of holiness, of the Spirit of Christ and His Gospel. This sort of persons are frequently marked in the Scripture as those who at least are nigh unto a final and fatal rejection. Fourthly, a voluntary relinquishment of the means of grace and of conversion to God which men have enjoyed, and this is commonly accompanied with the hatred of the Word and those by whom it is dispensed. Such persons God frequently, in that visibly, gives up in an irrecoverable way to the dominion of sin. He declares that He will have no more to do with them. Fifthly, the resolved choice of wicked, profane, unclean, scoffing society. It is very rare that any are recovered from that snare, and many other signs there are of the near approach of such a hardening judgment as shall give up men everlastingly to the service of sin. Oh, that poor sinners would awake before it is too late. Number two, this dominion of sin is evil and perverse, not only because it is unjust and usurped, but because it is always used and exercised unto ill ends, unto the hurt and ruin of them over whom it is. A tyrant, a usurper, may make use of his power and rule for good ends, for the good of them over whom he rules, but all the ends of the dominion of sin are evil to sinners. Sin in its rule will pretend fair, offer a number of advantages and satisfactions to their minds. They shall have wages for their work, pleasure and profit shall come in by it, yea, on a number of pretenses that will promise them eternal rest at the close of all, at least, that they shall not fail of it by anything they do in its service, and by such means it keeps them in security. But the whole real design of it, that which in all its power it operates towards, is the eternal ruin of their souls. And this sinners will understand when it is too late, Jeremiah 2:13-19. Secondly, this dominion of sin is not a mere force against the will and endeavors of them that are under it, where all the power and interest of sin consist in putting a force on the mind and soul by its temptations, there it has no dominion. It may perplex them, it does not rule over them. Where it has dominion, it has the force and power of a law in the wills and minds of them in whom it is. Hereby it requires obedience of them, and they yield themselves servants to obey it, Romans 6:16. Therefore, to this dominion of sin there is required a consent of the will in some measure and degree. The constant reluctancy and conquering prevalency of the will against it defeats its title to rule and dominion, as the Apostle declares at large in the next chapter. The will is the sovereign faculty and power of the soul. Whatever principle acts in it and determines it, that has the rule. Notwithstanding light and conviction, the determination of the whole as to duty and sin is in the power of the will. If the will of sinning be taken away, sin cannot have dominion. Here is wisdom. He that can distinguish between the impressions of sin upon him and the rule of sin in him is in the way of peace. But this oft times, as we shall further see, with the reason of it, is not easily to be attained. Convictions, on the one hand, will make a great pretense and appearance of an opposition in the will to sin by their unavoidable impressions on it when it is not so. and disturbed affections under temptations will plead that the will itself is given up to the choice and service of sin when it is not so. The will in this manner is like the Theban shield. While that was safe, they conceded themselves victorious even in death. However, this case is determined by the light of Scripture and experience, and it is here proposed to a determination. Thirdly, it is required to this dominion of sin that the soul be not under any other supreme conduct, that is, of the Spirit of God and of His grace, by the law. This is that which really has the sovereign rule in all believers. They are led by the Spirit, guided by the Spirit, acted and ruled by Him, and are thereby under the government of God and Christ and no other. With this, the rule of sin is absolutely inconsistent. No man can at once serve these two masters. Grace and sin may be in the same soul at the same time, but they cannot bear rule in the same soul at the same time. The throne is singular and will admit of but one ruler. Every evidence we have of being under the rule of grace is so that we are not under the dominion of sin. This, therefore, is the principal way and means which we have to secure our peace and comfort against the pretenses of sin to the disquietment of our consciences. Let us endeavor to preserve an experience of the rule of grace in our hearts, Colossians 3:15. Under a conduct and rule, whence our state is denominated, we are and must be. This is either of sin or grace. There is no composition, no co-partnership between them as to rule. As to residence there is, but not as unto rule. If we can assure ourselves of the one, we secure ourselves from the other. It is therefore our wisdom, and lies at the foundation of all our comforts, that we get evidences and experience of our being under the rule of grace. And it will evidence itself if we are not wanting unto a due observation of its acting and operation in us. And it will do it, among others, these two ways. Number one, by keeping up a constancy of design in living to God, and after conformity to Christ, notwithstanding the interposition of surprisals by temptations, and the most urgent solicitations of sin. This is called cleaving unto God with purpose of heart. Acts 11:23. This will be wherever grace has the rule. As a man that goes to a sea designs some certain place and port where he guides his course, in his way he meets, it may be, with storms and crosswinds that drive him out of his course, and sometimes directly backward towards a place whence he set forth, but his design still holds, and in the pursuit of it he applies his skill and industry to retrieve and recover all his losses and backdrivings by crosswinds and storms. So is it with the soul under the conduct of grace. Its fixed design is to live to God, but in its course it meets with storms and crosswinds of temptations and various artifices of sin. These disturb him, disorder him, drive him backward sometimes as if it would take a contrary course and return to the coast of sin from whence it set out. But where grace has the rule in conduct, it will weather all these oppositions and obstructions. It will restore the soul, bring it again into order, recover it from the confusions of evil frames that it was drawn into. It will give a fresh predominancy to its prevalent design of living to God in all things. It will do this constantly, as often as the soul meets with such ruffles from the power of sin. When there is a radical firmitude and strength in a cause or design, it will work itself out through all changes and variations. But when the strength of any cause is but occasion, the first opposition and disorder will ruin us. So if men's purpose of living to God be only occasional, from present convictions, the first vigorous opposition or temptation will disorder it and overthrow it. But where this is the radical design of the soul, from the power of grace, it will break through all such oppositions and recover its prevalency in the mind and affections. Hereby doth it evidence its rule, and that the whole interest of sin in the soul is by rebellion and not by virtue of dominion. Number two, it does so by keeping up a constant exercise of grace in all religious duties, or at least a sincere endeavor that so it may be. Where sin has the dominion, it can allow the soul to perform religious duties, yea, in some cases to abound in them, but it will take care that divine grace be not exercised in them. Whatever there may be of delight in duties or other motions of affection which light and gifts and afflictions and superstition will occasion, there is no exercise of faith and love in them. This belongs essentially and inseparably to the rule of grace. Wherever that bears sway, the soul will endeavor the constant exercise of grace in all its duties, and never be satisfied in the work done without some sense of it. Where it fails in it, it will judge itself and watch against the like surprisals. Yea, unless it be in case of some great temptation, the present sense of the guilt of sin, which is the highest obstruction against that spiritual boldness which is required to the due exercise of grace, that is, of faith and love and holy duties, shall not hinder the soul from endeavoring after it or the use of it. If by these means, in the like inseparable operations of grace, we can have an assuring experience that we are under the rule and conduct of it, we may be free in our minds from disturbing apprehensions of the dominion of sin, for both cannot bear sway in the same soul. Fourthly, it is required to this that sin make the soul sensible of its power and rule, at least do that which may do so, unless conscience be utterly seared and hardened, and so past feeling. There is no rule or dominion, but they are or may be sensible of it who are subject thereunto. And there are two ways in which sin and its dominion will make them sensible of it in whom it rules. First, in repressing and overcoming the efficacy of the convictions of the mind. Those who are under the dominion of sin, as we shall see more immediately, may have light to and conviction of their duty in many things, and this light and conviction they may follow ordinarily, notwithstanding the dominion of sin. As a tyrant will permit his slaves and subjects ordinarily to follow their own occasions, but if what they would do come, either in matter or manner, to interfere with or oppose his interest, he will make them sensible of his power. So sin, where it hath the dominion, if men have light and conviction, will allow them ordinarily and in many things to comply therewith. It will allow them to pray, to hear the word, to abstain from a number of sins, to perform many duties, as is expressly affirmed in the scripture of many that were under the power of sin. And we see it in experience. How much work do we see about religion and religious duties? What constant observation of the times and seasons of them? How many duties performed morally good in themselves and useful by them who on many other accounts do proclaim themselves to be under the dominion of sin? But if the light and conviction of the sort of persons do rise up in opposition to the principal interest of sin in those lusts, in ways in which it exercises its rule, it will make them in whom they are sensible of its power. They that stifle or shut their eyes against, or cast out of the mind, or go directly contrary to their convictions, light in such cases will first repine and then relieve itself with resolutions for other times and seasons. But sin will carry the cause by virtue of its dominion. Hence two things follow. First, a constant repugnancy against sin from light in the mind and conviction in the conscience does not prove that those in whom it is are not under the dominion of sin. For until blindness and hardness do come on men to the uttermost, there will be in them a judging of what is good and evil, with a self-judging with respect thereunto, as the Apostle declares in Romans 2:15. And herein many do satisfy themselves. When their light condemns sin, they suppose they hate it, but they do not. When convictions call for duties, they suppose they love them, but they do not. That which they look on as the rule of light in them, in opposition to sin, is but the rebellion of a natural enlightened conscience against the dominion of it in the heart. In brief, light may condemn every known sin, keep from many, press for every known duty, lead to the performance of many, yet sin shall have a full dominion in the soul, and this it will evidence when it comes to the trial, in those instances where it exercises its ruling power. Secondly, that miserable is their condition whose minds are ground continually between the conduct of their light with the urgency of conviction on the one hand, and a ruler dominion of sin on the other. Wherever light is, it is its due to have the rule and conduct. It is that art in which the mind leads itself. For men to be forced, by the power of their lusts, to act for the most part against their light, as they do where sin has a dominion, it is a sad and deplorable condition. Such persons are said to rebel against the light, Job 24:13, because of its right to rule in them, where it is deposed by sin. This makes most men but a troubled sea that cannot rest, whose waters cast up mire and dirt. Number 2. Sin will make those in whom it has dominion sensible of its power by its continual solicitation of the mind and affections with respect to that sin, or those sins in which it principally exercises its rule. Having possessed the will and inclinations of the mind, with the affections, as it does wherever its dominion is absolute, it continually disposes, inclines, and stirs up the mind towards those sins. It will level the bent of the whole soul towards such sins or the circumstances of them. Nor is there a more pregnant discovery of the rule of sin in any than this, that it habitually engages the mind and affections to a constant exercise of themselves about this or that, some sin in evil way or other. But yet we must add that notwithstanding these inclinations of the ruling power of sin, they are but few in whom it has this dominion that are convinced of their state and condition. Many are so under the power of darkness, of supine sloth and negligence, and are so desperately wicked, as that they have no sense of this rule of sin. Such are those described by the Apostle in Ephesians 4:18-19. And whereas they are the vilest slaves that live on the earth, they judge none to be free but themselves. They look on others as in bondage to foolish and superstitious fears, while they are at liberty to drink, swear, scoff at religion, whore, and defile themselves without control. This is their liberty, and they may have that which is as good in hell, a liberty to curse and blaspheme God, and to fly with revengeful thoughts on themselves and the whole creation. Delight in such persons is darkness itself. So be that they have nothing to rise up in opposition to the rule of sin, whence alone a sense of its power doth arise. Others, as we have observed before, living in some compliance with their light and convictions, abstaining from many sins and performing many duties, though they live in some known sin or other and allow themselves in it, yet will not allow that sin has the dominion in them. Wherefore, there are two things hard and difficult in this case. Number one, to convince those in whom sin evidently has the dominion that such indeed is their state and condition. They will with their utmost endeavor keep off the convictions of it. Some justify themselves, some excuse themselves, and some will make no inquiry into this matter. It is a rare thing, especially of late, to have any brought under this conviction by the preaching of the word, though it be the case of multitudes that attend to it. Number two, to satisfy some that sin has not the dominion over them, notwithstanding its restless acting itself in them and warring against their souls, yet unless this can be done, it is impossible they should enjoy solid peace and comfort in this life. And the concernment of the best of believers, while they are in this world, does lie in this, for as they grow in light, spirituality, experience, freedom of mind, and humility, the more they love to know of the deceit, activity, and power of the remainders of sin. And although it works not at all, at least not sensibly in them, towards those sins in which it reigns and rages in others, yet they are able to discern its more subtle inward and spiritual actings in the mind and heart, to the weakening of grace, the obstructing of its effectual operations and holy duties, with many indispositions to stability in the life of God which fills them with trouble. Of the Dominion of Sin and Grace, Chapter 3. The second inquiry spoken to, whether sin has dominion in us or not, in answer to which it is showed that some wear sin's livery, and they are the professed servants of it, there are many in which the case is dubious, where sin's service is not so discernible. Several exceptions are put in against its dominion where it seems to prevail, some certain signs of its dominion, graces and duties to be exercised for its mortification. Section 2. These things being thus premised in general concerning the nature of the dominion of sin, we shall now proceed to our principal inquiry, namely, whether sin have dominion in us or no, whereby we may know whether we are under the law or under grace, or what is the state of our souls towards God. An inquiry this is, which is very necessary for some to make, and for all to have rightly determined in their minds, from Scripture and experience. For on that determination depends all our solid peace. Sin will be in us. It will lust, fight, and entice. But the great question, as to our peace and comfort, is whether it has dominion over us or not. First, we do not inquire concerning them in whom the reign of sin is absolute and easily discernible, if not to themselves, yet to others. Such there are who visibly yield their members instruments of unrighteousness to sin, Romans 6:13. Sin reigns in their mortal bodies, and they openly obey it in the lusts thereof, verse 12. They are avowedly servants of sin to death, verse 16, and are not ashamed of it. The show of their countenance doth witness against them, and they declare their sin as Sodom. They hide it not, Isaiah 3:9. Such are those described in Ephesians 4:18 and 19, and such the world is filled with. Such as, being under the power of darkness and enmity against God, do act him in opposition to all serious godliness in the service of various lusts. There is no question concerning their state. They cannot themselves deny that it is so with them. I speak not for the liberty of censoring, but for the easiness of judging. Those who openly wear sin's livery may well be esteemed to be sin's servants, and they shall not fail to receive sin's wages. Let them at present bear it never so high, and despise all manner of convictions, they will find it bitterness in the latter end. Isaiah 50:11 and Ecclesiastes 11:9. Secondly, but there are many in whom the case is dubious and not easily to be determined. For, on the one hand, they may have a number of things in them which may seem repugnant to the reign of sin, but indeed are not inconsistent with it. All arguments and pleas from them and their vindication may fail them on a trial. And on the other hand, there may be some in whom the effectual working of sin may be so great and perplexing as to argue that it has the dominion, when indeed it has not, but is only a stubborn rebel. The things of the first sort, which seem destructive of and inconsistent with the dominion of sin, but indeed are not, may be referred to five heads. Number one, illumination and knowledge and spiritual gifts, with convictions of good and evil, of all known duties and sins. This is that which some men live in a perpetual rebellion against in one instance or another. Number two, a change in the affections, given a temporary delight in religious duties with some constancy in their observation. This also is found in many who are yet evidently under the power of sin and spiritual darkness. Number three, a performance of many duties, both moral and evangelical, for the substance of them, and an abstinence out of conscience from many sins. So was it with the young man in the gospel, who yet lacked what was necessary to free him from the dominion of sin. Matthew 19:20-23. Number four, repentance for sin committed. This is that which most secure themselves by, and a blessed security it is when it is gracious, evangelical, a fruit of faith, comprising the return of the whole soul to God. But there is that which is legal, partial, respecting particular sins only, which is not pleadable in this case. Ahab was no less under the dominion of sin when he had repented him than he was before, and Judas repented him before he hanged himself. Number five, promises and resolutions against sin for the future. But the goodness of many in these things is as a morning cloud, and as the early dew it goeth away, as it is in the prophet Hosea 6:4. Where there is a concurrence of these things in any, they have good hopes, at least they are not under the dominion of sin, nor is it easy to convince them that they are, and they may so behave themselves in it, as that it is not consistent with Christian charity to pronounce them to be so. Howbeit, the fallacy that is in these things has been detected by many, and much more is by all required to evidence the sincerity of faith and holiness. No man, therefore, can be acquitted by pleas taken from them as to his subjection to the reign of sin. The things of the second sort, whence arguments may be taken to prove the dominion of sin in any person, which yet will not certainly do it, are those which we shall now examine. And we must observe, number one, that where sin has the dominion, it doth indeed rule in the whole soul and all the faculties of it. It is a vicious habit in all of them, corrupting them in their several natures and powers, with that corruption in which they are capable. So in the mind of darkness and vanity, the will of spiritual deceit and perverseness, the heart of stubbornness and sensuality, sin in its power reaches to and affects them all. But number two, it doth evidence its dominion and is to be tried by its acting in the distinct faculties of the mind, in the frame of the heart, and in the course of the life. There are those which we shall examine. First, those which render the case dubious, and then those that clearly determine it on the part of sin. I shall not, therefore, at present give positive evidences of men's freedom from the dominion of sin, but only consider the arguments that lie against them, and examine how far they are conclusive, or how they may be defeated. Number one, when sin has in any instance possessed the imagination, and by this engaged a cogitative faculty in its service, it is a dangerous symptom of its rule or dominion. Sin may exercise its rule in the mind, fancy, and imagination, where bodily strength or opportunity gives no advantage for its outward perpetration. In them the desires of sin may be enlarged as hell, and the satisfaction of lust taken in with greediness. Pride and covetousness and sensuality may reign and rage in the mind by corrupt imaginations, when their outward exercise is shut up by circumstances of life. The first way in which sin acts itself, or coins its motions and inclination in two acts, is by the imagination, Genesis 6:5. The continual evil figments of the heart are as the bubbling of corrupt waters from a corrupted fountain. The imaginations intended are the fixing of the mind on the objects of sin or sinful objects by continual thoughts with delight and complacency. They are the mind's purveying for the satisfaction of the flesh and the lust thereof, Romans 13:14, whereby evil thoughts come to lodge, to abide, to dwell in the heart, Jeremiah 4:14. This is the first and proper effect of that vanity of mind in which the soul is alienated from the life of God. Click. The mind being turned off from its proper object, with the dislike of it, applies itself by its thoughts and imaginations to the pleasures and advantages of sin, seeking in vain to recover the rest and satisfaction which they have forsaken in God Himself. They follow after lying vanities, and forsake their own mercies, Jonah 2:8. And when they give themselves up to a constant internal converse with the desires of the flesh, the pleasures and advantages of sin, with delight and approbation, sin may reign triumphantly in them, though no appearance be made of it in their outward conversation. Such are they who have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. Their hearts have been filled with the litter of ungodly lusts, as the Apostle declares in 2 Timothy 3:5. And there are three evils with respect whereunto sin does exercise its reigning power in the imagination and in a special manner. First, pride, self-elation, desire of power and greatness. It is affirmed by the prince of Tyrus that he said he was a god and sat in the seat of God, Ezekiel 28:2, and the like foolish thoughts are ascribed to the king of Babylon, Isaiah 14:13 and 14. None of the children of men can attain so great glory, power, and dominion in this world, but that in their imaginations and desires they can infinitely exceed what they do enjoy, like him who wept that he had not another world to conquer. They have no bounds but to be as God, yea, to be God, which was the first design of sin in the world. And there is none so poor and low but by his imaginations he can lift up and exalt himself almost into the place of God. This vanity and madness God reproves in his discourse with Job in chapter 49-14. And there is nothing more germane and proper to the original deprivation and corruption of our natures than the self-exaltation and foolish thoughts and imaginations, because it first came upon it through a desire of being as God. And this, therefore, may sin exercise its dominion in the minds of men, yea, in the empty wind and vanity of these imaginations, with those that follow, consists the principal part of the deceitful ways of sin. The ways of men cannot satisfy themselves with what sins they can actually commit, but in these imaginations they rove endlessly, finding satisfaction in their renovation and variety. Isaiah 57:10. Secondly, sensuality and uncleanness of life. It is said of some that they have eyes full of adultery, and that they cannot cease from sin, 2 Peter 2:14. That is, their imaginations are continually working about the objects of their unclean lusts. These they think of night and day, immiring themselves in all filth continually. Jude calls them filthy dreamers, defiled in the flesh, verse 8. They live as in a constant pleasing dream by their vile imaginations, even when they cannot accomplish their lustful desires. For such imaginations cannot be better expressed than by dreams, in which men satisfy themselves with a supposed acting of what they do not. Hereby do many wallow in the mire of uncleanness all their days, and for the most part are never lacking to the effects of it when they have opportunity and advantage. And by this means the most cloistered recluses may live in constant adulteries, in which multitudes of them become actually the sinks of uncleanness. This is that which in the root of it is severely condemned by our Savior in Matthew 5:28. Thirdly, unbelief, distrust, and hard thoughts of God are of the same kind. These will sometimes so possess the imaginations of men as to keep them off from all delight in God, to put them on contrivances of fleeing from Him, which is a peculiar case not here to be spoken to. And these, in the like ways, may sin exercises dominion in the soul by the mind and its imagination. It may do so when no demonstration is made of it in the outward conversation. For by this means the minds of men are defiled, and then nothing is clean, all things are impure to them, Titus 1:15. Their minds being thus defiled do defile all things to them, their enjoyments, their duties, all they have and all that they do. But yet all failing and sin in this kind does not prove absolutely that sin has the dominion in the mind that it had before. Something of this vice and evil may be found in them that are freed from the reign of sin, and there will be so until the vanity of our minds is perfectly cured and taken away, which will not be in this world. Therefore I shall name the exceptions that may be put in against the title of sin to dominion in the soul, notwithstanding the continuance in some measure of this work of the imagination in coining evil figments in the heart. First, this is no evidence of the dominion of sin where it is occasionally arising from the prevalency of some present temptation. Take an instance in the case of David. I no way doubt but that in his temptation with Bathsheba his mind was possessed with defiling imaginations. Therefore, on his repentance, he not only prays for the forgiveness of his sin, but cries out with all fervency that God would create a clean heart in him. Psalm 51:10. He was sensible not only of the defilement of his person by his actual adultery, but of his heart by impure imaginations. So it may be in the case of other temptations. While men are entangled with any temptation, of what sort soever it be, it will multiply thoughts about it in the mind. Yea, its whole power consists in a multiplication of evil imaginations. By them it blinds the mind, draws it off from the consideration of its duty, and entices it to a full conception of sin, James 1:14-15. Therefore, in this case of a prevalent temptation which may befall a true believer, the corrupt working of the imagination does not prove the dominion of sin. If it be inquired how the mind may be freed and cleared of these perplexing, defiling imaginations, which arise from the urgency of some present temptation, suppose about earthly affairs or the like, I say it never will be done by the most strict watch and resolution against them, nor by the most resolute rejection of them. They will return with new violence and new pretenses, though the soul has promised itself 1,000 times that they should not do so. There is but one way for the cure of this distemper, and this is a thorough mortification of the lust that feeds them and is fed by them. It is to no purpose to shake off the fruit in this case unless we dig up the root. Every temptation designs the satisfaction of some lust of the flesh or of the mind. These evil thoughts and imaginations are the working of the temptation in the mind. There is no riddance of them, no conquest to be obtained over them, but by subduing the temptation, and no subduing the temptation but by the mortification of the lust whose satisfaction it is designed to. This course the Apostle directs to in Colossians 3:3-5. That which he enjoins is that we would not set our minds on the things of the earth in opposition to the things above. That is, that we would not feel our imaginations and by this our affections with them. But what is the way in which we may be enabled so to do? That is, he says, the universal mortification of sin, verse 5. For lack of the wisdom and knowledge of this, or for lack of its practice, through a secret unwillingness to come up to a full mortification of sin, Some are galled and perplexed, yea, and defiled with foolish and vain imaginations all their days. And although they prove not the dominion of sin, yet they will deprive the soul of that peace and comfort which otherwise it might enjoy. But yet there is much spiritual skill and diligence required to discover what is the true root and spring of the foolish imaginations that may at any time possess the mind. For they lie deep in the heart, that heart which is deep and deceitful, and so are not easily discoverable. There are many other pretenses of them. They do not directly bespeak that pride or those unclean lusts which they proceed from, but they make many other pretenses and feign other ends, but the soul that is watchful and diligent may trace them to their original. And if such thoughts are strictly examined at any time, what is their design, whose work they do, what makes them so busy in the mind, they will confess the truth, both whence they came and what it is they aim at. Then is the mind guided to its duty, which is the extermination of the lusts which they would make provision for. Secondly, such imaginations are no evidence of the dominion of sin. In what degree soever they are, where they are afflictive, where they are a burden to the soul, which it groans under and would be delivered from. There is a full account given by the apostle of the conflict between indwelling sin and grace, Romans 7, and the things which he ascribes to sin are not the first rising or involuntary motions of it, not merely its inclinations and disposition, for the things ascribed to it is that it fights, rebels, wars, leads captive, acts as a law, cannot belong to them. Nor does he intend the outward acting or perpetration of sin, the doing or accomplishing or finishing of it, for that cannot befall believers, as the apostle declares in 1 John 3:9. But is the working of sin by these imaginations in the mind, in the engagement of the affections thereon, that he doth intend? Now this he declares to be the great burden of the souls of believers, that which makes them think their condition wretched and miserable in some sort, and which they earnestly cry out for deliverance from, in Romans 7:24. This is the present case. These figments of the heart, these imaginations will arise in the minds of men. They will do so sometimes to a high degree. They will impose them on us with deceit and violence, leading captive to the law of them. Where they are rejected, condemned, defied, they will return again while there is any vanity remaining in the mind or corruption in the affections. But if the soul be sensible of them, if it labor under them, if it look on them as those that fight against its purity, holiness, and peace, if it pray for deliverance from them, they are no argument of the dominion of sin. Yea, a great evidence to the contrary may be taken from that firm opposition to them which the mind is constantly engaged in. Thirdly, they are not proofs of the dominion of sin when there is a prevalent detestation of the lust from whence they proceed, and whose promotion they design, maintained in the heart and mind. I confess sometimes this cannot be discovered, and all such various imaginations are but mere effects of the incurable vanity and instability of our minds, for these administer continual occasion to random thoughts. But for the most part, as we observed before, they are employed in the service of some lust and tend to the satisfaction of it. They are that which is prohibited by the apostle in Romans 13:14, make not provision for the flesh. And this may be discovered on strict examination. Now when the mind is fixed in a constant detestation of the sin in which they lead, as it is sin against God, with a firm resolution against it, in all circumstances that may occur, no proof can be thence taken for the dominion of sin. Number 4. Sometimes evil thoughts are the immediate injections of Satan, and they are on many accounts most terrible to the soul. Usually for the matters of them, they are dreadful and oft-times blasphemous. And as to the manner of their entrance into the mind, it is for the most part surprising, furious, and irresistible. From such thoughts many have concluded themselves to be absolutely under the power of sin and Satan, but they are by certain rules and infallible signs discoverable from whence they do proceed, and on that discovery all pretenses to the dominion of sin in them must disappear. And this is the first case which renders the question dubious whether sin have the dominion in us or no. Number 2. It is a sign of the dominion of sin when in any instance it has a prevalency in our affections. Yea, they are the throne of sin where it acts its power. But this case of the affections I have handled so at large in my discourse of spiritual mindedness, as I shall here briefly speak to it, so as to give one rule only to make a judgment by concerning the dominion of sin in them. This is certain, that where sin has a prevalency and predominancy in our affections, there it has the dominion in the soul. The rule is given us unto this purpose, 1 John 2:15. We are obliged to love the Lord our God with all our hearts and with all our soul, and therefore if there be in us a predominant love to anything else, in which it is preferred to God, it must be from the prevalency of a principle of sin in us. And so it is with respect to all other affections. If we love anything more than God, as we do, if we will not part with it for His sake, be it as a right eye or as a right hand to us, if we take more satisfaction and complacency in it, and cleave more to it in our thoughts and minds than to God, as men commonly do in their lusts, interests, enjoyments, and relations, if we trust more to it as to a supply of our lacks than to God, as most do to the world, if our desires are enlarged and our diligence heightened in seeking after and attaining other things more than towards the love and favor of God, if we fear the loss of other things or danger from them more than we fear God, we are not under the rule of God or His grace, but we are under the dominion of sin which reigns in our affections. It were endless to give instances of this power of sin in and over the affections of men. Self-love, love of the world, delight in things sensual, and overvaluation of relations and enjoyments, which a number of other things of an alike nature will easily evidence it. And to resolve the case under consideration, we may observe, first, that the prevalency of sin in the affection, so far as to be a symptom of its dominion, is discernible to the least beam of spiritual light, with a diligent searching into and judgment of ourselves. If it be so with any that they know it not, nor will be convinced of it, as it is with many, I know not what can free them from being under the reign of sin. And we see it so every day. Men, all whose ways and actions proclaim that they are acted in all things by an inordinate love of the world and self, yet find nothing amiss in themselves, nothing that they do not approve of, unless it be that their desires are not satisfied according to their expectations. All the commands we have in the Scripture for self-searching, trial, and examination, all the rules that are given us unto that end, all the warnings we have of the deceitfulness of sin and of our own hearts, are given us to prevent this evil of shutting our eyes against a prevalent corruption and disorder of our affections. And the issue of all our endeavors in this kind is in the appeal of David to God Himself. Psalm 139:23-24. Secondly, when men have convictions of the irregularity and disorder of their affections, yet are resolved to continue in the state in which they are without the correction and amendment of them, because of some advantage and satisfaction which they receive in their present state, they seem to be under the dominion of sin. So is it with those mentioned in Isaiah 57:10. Upon the account of the present satisfaction, delight, and pleasure that their corrupt affections do take in cleaving inordinately to their objects, they will not endeavor their change and alterations. This, then, is a soul safe rule in this case. Whatever hold sin may have got on our affections, whatever prevalency it may have in them, however it may entangle and defile them, if we endeavor sincerely the discovery of this evil, and thereon set ourselves constantly to the mortification of our corrupt affections by all due means, there is not in their disorder any argument to prove the dominion of sin in us. Our affections, as they are corrupt, are the proper objects of the great duty of mortification, which the Apostle therefore calls our members which are upon the earth. Colossians 3:5. This is a safe anchor for the soul in the storm. If it live in a sincere endeavor, after the mortification of every discoverable corruption and disorder in the affections, it is secure from the dominion of sin. But as for such as are negligent in searching after the state of their souls, as to the inclination and engagement of their affections, who approve of themselves in their greatest irregularities, resolvedly indulge themselves in any way of sin to gratify their corrupt affections, they must provide themselves of pleas for their vindication. I know them not. But the meaning of our present rule will be further manifest in what ensues. Number 3. It is a dangerous sign of the dominion of sin when, after a conviction of their necessity, it prevails to a neglect of those ways and duties which are peculiarly suited, directed, and ordained to its mortification and destruction. This may be cleared in some particulars. First, mortification of sin is the constant duty of all believers, of all who would not have sin have dominion over them. Where mortification is sincere, there is no dominion of sin, and where there is no mortification, there sin doth reign. Secondly, there are some graces and duties that are peculiarly suited and ordained to the sin, that by them and their agency the work of mortification may be carried on constantly in our souls. What they are, or some of them, we shall see immediately. Thirdly, when sin puts forth its power in any special lust or in a strong inclination to any actual sin, then it is the duty of the soul to make diligent application of those graces and duties which are specific and proper to its mortification. Fourth, when men have had a conviction of these duties and have attended to them according to that conviction, if sin prevail in them to a neglect or relinquishment of those duties as to their performance, or as to their application to the mortification of sin, it is a dangerous sign that sin hath dominion in them. And I distinguish between these things, namely, a neglect of such duties as to their performance, and a neglect of the application of them to the mortification of sin. For men may on other accounts continue the observance of them, or some of them, and yet not apply them to the special end. And so all external duties may be observed when sin reigns in triumph. 2 Timothy 3:5. The meaning of the assertion being stated, I shall now name some of those graces and duties upon whose omission and neglect sin may prevail as to an application of them to the mortification of any sin. The first is the daily exercise of faith on Christ as crucified. This is the great fundamental means of the mortification of sin in general, and which we ought to apply to every particular instance of it. This the Apostle discourses at large in Romans 6:6-13. Our old man, he says, is crucified with Christ, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Our old man, or the body of sin, is the power and reign of sin in us. These are to be destroyed, that is, so mortified that henceforth we should not serve sin, that we should be delivered from the power and rule of it. This, says the Apostle, is done in Christ, crucified with him. It is so meritoriously in his actual dying or being crucified for us. It is so virtually because of the certain provision that is made therein for the mortification of all sin. But it is so actually by the exercise of faith on him as crucified, dead, and buried, which is a means of the actual communication of the virtue of his death to us for that end. Herein are we said to be dead and buried with him, in which baptism is the pledge. So by the cross of Christ, the world is crucified to us, and we are so to the world, Galatians 6:14, which is the substance of the mortification of all sin. There are several ways in which the exercise of faith on Christ crucified is effectual to the sin. First, looking unto him as such will beget holy mourning in us, Zechariah 12:10. They shall look on me whom they have pierced and mourn. It is a promise of gospel times and gospel grace. A view of Christ as pierced will cause mourning in them that have received the promise of the Spirit of grace and supplication there mentioned. And this mourning is a foundation of mortification. It is that godly sorrow which worketh repentance to salvation not to be repented of, 2 Corinthians 7:10. And mortification of sin is the essence of repentance. The more believers are exercised in this view of Christ, the more humble they are, the more they are kept in that mourning frame which is universally opposite to all the interests of sin and which keeps the soul watchful against all its attempts. Sin never reigned in an humble, mourning soul. Secondly, it is effectual to the same end by the way of a powerful motive as that which calls and leads to conformity to him. This is pressed by the Apostle in Romans 6, 8-11. Our conformity to Christ as crucified and dead consists in our being dead to sin, and by this overthrowing the reign of it in our mortal bodies. This conformity, he says, we ought to reckon on as our duty. Reckon ye yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin. That is, that you ought so to be in that conformity which you ought to aim at, to Christ crucified? Can any spiritual eye behold Christ dying for sin and continue to live in sin? Shall we keep that alive in us which he died for, that it might not eternally destroy us? Can we behold him bleeding for our sins and not endeavor to give them their death wound? The efficacy of the exercise of faith in this to the mortification of sin is known to all believers by experience. Thirdly, faith in this gives us communion with him in his death and unites the soul to it in its efficacy. Hence we are said to be buried with him into death and to be planted together in the likeness of his death, Romans 6, 4 and 5. Our old man is crucified with him, verse 6. We have by faith communion with him in his death, to the death of sin. This, therefore, is the first grace and duty which we ought to attend to for the mortification of sin. But where sin has this interest and power in the mind is to take it off from this exercise of faith, to prevent or obstruct it, as it will do, so as that it shall not dare to think or meditate on Christ crucified because of the inconsistency of such thoughts with an indulgence to any lust. It is to be feared that sin is in the throne. If it be thus with any, if they have not yet made use of this way and means for the mortification of sin, or if, being convinced of it, they have been for any season driven or withheld from the exercise of faith in it, I have nothing to offer to free them from this evidence of the reign of sin, but only that they should speedily and carefully address themselves to their duty in it, and if they prevail on themselves to it, it will bring in its own evidence of their freedom. Some, it may be, will say that indeed they are unskillful in this word of righteousness, as some are, Hebrews 5:13. They don't know how to make use of Christ crucified to the sin, nor how to set themselves about it. Other ways of mortification they can understand. The discipline and penances assigned by the papists to the sin are sensible. So are our own vows and resolutions with other duties that are prescribed. But as for this way of deriving virtue from the death of Christ to the death of sin, they can understand nothing of it. I easily believe that some may say so, yea, ought to say so, if they would speak their minds, for the spiritual wisdom of faith is required unto this, but all men have not faith. On the loss of this wisdom, the papists have invented another way to supply the old exercise of faith in it. They will make crucifixes, images of Christ crucified. Then they will adore, embrace, mourn over, and expect great virtue from them. Without these images, they know no way of addressing to Christ for the communication of any virtue from his death or life. Others may be at the same loss, but they may do well to consider the cause of it. For is it not from ignorance of the mystery of the gospel, and of the communication of supplies of spiritual things from Christ in it, of the efficacy of his life and death to our sanctification and mortification of sin? Or is it not because, indeed, they have never been thoroughly distressed in their mind and consciences by the power of sin, and so have never in good earnest looked for relief? Light, general convictions, either of the guilt or power of sin, will drive none to Christ. When their consciences are reduced to real straits and they know not what to do, they will learn better how to look to him whom they have pierced. Their condition, whoever they are, is dangerous, who find not a necessity every day of applying themselves by faith to Christ for help and succor. Or is it not because they have other reliefs to betake themselves to? Such are their own promises and resolutions, which, for the most part, serve only to cheat and quiet conscience for an hour or a day, and then vanish into nothing. But whatever be the cause of this neglect, those in whom it is will pine away in their sins, for nothing but the death of Christ for us will be the death of sin in us. Secondly, another duty necessary to this end is continual prayer, and this is to be considered as to its application to the prevalency of any particular lust in which sin doth in a peculiar manner exert its power. This is a great ordinance of God for its mortification, for first, by this we obtain spiritual aids and supplies of strength against it. We are not more necessarily and fervently to pray that sin may be pardoned as to its guilt than we are that it may be subdued as to its power. He who is negligent in the latter is never in good earnest in the former. The pressures and troubles which we receive from the power of sin are as pungent on the mind as those from its guilt are on the conscience. Mere pardon of sin will never give peace to a soul, though it can have none without it. It must be mortified also, or we can have no spiritual rest. Now this is the work of prayer, namely to seek and obtain such supplies of mortifying, sanctifying grace, as by this the power of sin may be broken, its strength abated, its root withered, its life destroyed, and so the whole man crucified. That which was the apostles' request for the Thessalonians is the daily prayer of all believers for themselves, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Secondly, a constant attendance to this duty in a due manner will preserve the soul in such a frame as therein sin can habitually prevail in it. And he that can live in sin and abide in the ordinary duties of prayer doth never once pray as he ought. Formality or some secret reserve or other vitiates the whole. A truly gracious praying frame in which we pray always is utterly inconsistent with the love of or reserve for any sin. To pray well is to pray always, that is, to keep the heart always in that frame which is required in prayer, and where this is, sin can have no rule, no, nor quiet harbor in the soul. Thirdly, it is the soul's immediate conflict against the power of sin. Sin in it is formally considered as the soul's enemy, which fights against it. In prayer, the soul sets itself to grapple with it, to wound, kill, and destroy. It is that in which it applies all its spiritual engines to its utter ruin. In it, it exercises a gracious abhorrency of it, a clear self-condemnation on the account of it, and engages faith on all the promises of God for its conquest and destruction. It is hence evident that if sin has prevailed in the mind to a negligence of this duty, either in general as to the effectual application of it to any special case where it exerts its power, it is an ill symptom of the dominion of sin in the soul. It is certain that unmortified sin indulged too, will gradually work out all due regard to this duty of prayer and alienate the mind from it, either as to the matter or manner of its performance. We see this exemplified every day in apostate professors. They have had a gift of prayer and were constant in the exercise of it, but the love of sin and living in it has devoured their gift and wholly taken off their minds from the duty itself, which is the proper character of hypocrites. Will he delight himself in the Almighty? Will he always call upon God? Job 27:10. He may do so for a season, but falling under the power of sin, he will not continue so to do. Now, because sin uses great deceit herein, and a gradual progress for attaining its end, and by this securing its dominion, we may, in a way of warning or caution, take notice of some of its steps, that the entrance of it may be opposed. For as the entrance of God's word giveth light, Psalm 119:130, the first putting forth of its power on the soul gives spiritual light to the mind, which is to be improved. So the entrance of sin, the first actings of it on the mind towards the neglect of this duty, brings a deceiving darkness with them, which is to be opposed. First, it will produce in the mind an unreadiness to this duty in its proper seasons. The heart should always rejoice in the approach of such seasons because of the delight in God which it has in them. To rejoice and be glad in all our approaches to God is every way required of us, and therefore with the thoughts of and on the approach of such seasons, we ought to groan in ourselves for such a preparedness of mind as may render us meet for that converse with God which we are called unto. But where sin begins to prevail, all things will be unready and out of order. Strange tergiversations will rise in the mind, either as to the duty itself or as to the manner of its performance. Customariness and formality are the principles which act themselves in this case. The body seems to carry the mind to the duty whether it will or not, rather than the mind to lead the body in its part of it, and it will employ itself in anything rather than in the work and duty that lies before it. In this, then, lies a great part of our wisdom in obviating the power of sin in us. Let us keep our hearts continually in a gracious disposition and readiness for this duty in all its proper seasons. If you lose this ground, you will yet go more backwards continually. Know, therefore, that there is no more effectual preservative of the soul from the power of sin than a gracious readiness for and disposition to this duty in private and public, according to its proper seasons. Secondly, in its progress, Unto readiness it will add unwillingness, for the mind prepossessed by sin finds it directly contrary to its present interest, disposition, and inclination. There is nothing in it but what troubles and disquiets him. As he said of the prophet, who is not willing to hear him any more, it speaks not good but evil of them continually. Hence a secret unwillingness prevails in the mind, and an aversion from a serious engagement in it, and the attendance of such persons to it is as if they were under a force and a compliance with custom and convictions. Thirdly, sin will at length prevail to a total neglect of this duty. This is an observation confirmed by long experience. If prayer does not constantly endeavor the ruin of sin, sin will ruin prayer and utterly alienate the soul from it. This is the way of backsliders in heart. As they grow in sin, they decay in prayer until they are weary of it and utterly relinquish it. So they speak in Malachi 1:13, "Behold, what a weariness is it, and ye have snuffed at it." They look on it as a task, as a burden, and are weary in attending it. Now when I place this as an effect of the prevalency of sin, namely a relinquishment of the duty of prayer, I do not intend that persons do wholly and absolutely, or as to all ways of it, public and private, in all seasons or occasions of it, give it over utterly. Few rise to that profligacy in sin, to such desperate resolution against God. It may be they will still attend to the stated seasons of prayer in families or public assemblies, at least drawing near to God with their lips. And they will, on surprises and dangers, personally cry to God, as the Scriptures everywhere testifies of them. But this only I intend, namely, that they will no more sincerely, immediately, and directly apply prayer to the mortification and ruin of that lust or corruption in which sin puts forth its power and rule in them. And where it is so, it seems to have the dominion. Of such an one, says the psalmist, he hath left off to be wise and to do good. He sets himself in a way that is not good. He abhors not evil. Psalm 36:3-4. But such a relinquishment of this duty as to the end mentioned, as is habitual and renders the soul secure under it, is intended. For there may, through the power of temptation, be a prevalency of this evil in believers for a season. So God complains of his people in Isaiah 43:22. Thou hast not called upon me, O Jacob, as thou hast been weary of me, O Israel. That is, comparatively, as to the fervency and sincerity of the duty required of them. Now when it is thus with believers for a season, through the power of sin and temptation, first, they do not approve of themselves in it. They will ever and anon call things to consideration and say, it is not with us as it should be, or as it was in former days. This thing is not good that we do, nor will it be peace in the latter end. Secondly, they will have secret resolutions of shaking themselves out of the dust of this evil state. They say in themselves, we will go and return to our first husband, for then it was better with us than now, as the church did in Hosea 2:7. Thirdly, everything that peculiarly befalls them in a way of mercy or affliction they look on as calls from God to deliver and recover them from their backsliding frame. Fourthly, they will receive in the warnings which are given them by the word preached, especially if their particular case be touched on or laid open. Fifthly, they will have no quiet rest or self-approbation until they come thoroughly off unto a healing and recovery such as that described in Hosea 14:1-4. Thus it may be with some over whom sin has not the dominion, yet ought the first entrance of it to be diligently washed against as that which tends to the danger and ruin of the soul. Thirdly, constant self-abasement, condemnation, and abhorrency is another duty that is directly opposed to the interest and rule of sin in the soul. No frame of mind is a better antidote against the poison of sin. He that walketh humbly walketh surely. God has a continual regard to mourners, those that are of a broken heart and a contrite spirit. It is a soil where all grace will thrive and flourish. A constant due sense of sin as sin, of our interest in it by nature and in the course of our lives, with a continual afflictive remembrance of some such instance of it as have had peculiar aggravations, issuing in a gracious self-abasement, is the soul's best posture in watching against all the deceits and incursions of sin. And this is a duty which we ought with all diligence to attend to. To keep our souls in a constant frame of mourning and self-abasement is the most necessary part of our wisdom with reference to all the ends of the life of God. And it is so far from having any inconsistency with those consolations and joys which the gospel tends unto us in believing, is that it is the only way to let them into the soul in a due manner. It is such mourners and those alone to whom evangelical comforts are administered. Isaiah 57:18. One of the first things that sin does when it aims at dominion is the destruction of this frame of mind. And when it actually has a rule, it will not suffer it to enter. It makes men careless and regardless of this matter, yea, bold, presumptuous, and fearless. It will obstruct all the entrance into the mind of such self-reflections and considerations as lead unto this frame. It will represent them either as needless or unseasonable, or make the mind afraid of them as things which tend to its disquietment and disturbance without any advantage. If it prevails in this, it makes way for the security of its own dominion. Nothing is more washed against than a proud, regardless, senseless, secure frame of heart by them who are under the rule of grace. Fourthly, a reserve for any one known sin against the light and efficacy of convictions is an argument of the dominion of sin. So was it in the case of Naaman. He would do all other things, but put in an exception for that whereon his honor and profit did depend. Where there is sincerity and conviction, it extends itself unto all sins, for it is of sin as sin, and so of every known sin equally that has the nature of sin in it. And to be true to convictions is a life of sincerity. If men can make a choice of what they will accept and reserve, notwithstanding their being convinced of its evil, it is from the ruling power of sin. Please in the mind in the behalf of any sin, that is, for a continuance in it, prevalent thereunto, ruin all sincerity. It may be the pretense is that it is but a little one, of no great moment, and that which shall be compensated with other duties of obedience, or it shall be retained only until a fitter season for its relinquishment, or men may be blinded after conviction to dispute again whether what they would abide in be sinful or not. Is this a case frequently with respect unto covetousness, pride, and conformity to the world? It is a dreadful effect of the ruling power of sin. Whatever impeaches the universality of obedience in one thing overthrows its sincerity in all things. At this point, I want to quote from Solomon Stoddard, the Puritan and grandfather of Jonathan Edwards, about the way to know the difference between sincerity and hypocrisy, because this quote here by John Owen reminds me so much of Solomon Stoddard's own statements, quoted in Jonathan Edwards on a treatise on the religious affections. Solomon Stoddard wrote, "He that pretends to godliness and turns aside to crooked ways is an hypocrite. For those that are really godly do live in a way of obedience," Psalm 119:1-3. "Blessed are the undefiled in the way that walk in the law of the Lord. They also do no iniquity." Luke 1:6. "They were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments of the Lord blameless. But such as live in ways of sin are dissimulars, for all such will be rejected in the day of judgment." Matthew 7:23. "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." The like we have in Luke 13:27. "If men live in a way of disobedience, they do not love God, for love will make men keep God's commandments." 1 John 5:3. "Herein is love, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous." If men live in a way of disobedience, they have not a spirit of faith, for faith sanctifies men. Acts 26:18. "Sanctified by faith that is in me." If men live in a way of disobedience, they are not Christ's sheep, for his sheep hear his voice. John 10:27. Men that live in a way of disobedience are not born of God. 1 John 3:9. "He that is born of God sinneth not." Men that live in a way of disobedience are the servants of sin. John 8:34. "He that committeth sin is the servant of sin." A course of external sin is an evidence of hypocrisy, whether it be a sin of omission or commission. If men live in the neglect of known duties or in the practice of known evils, that will be their condemnation, let the sin be what it will, let it be profaneness, uncleanness, lying, or injustice. If men allow themselves in malice, envy, wanton thoughts, profane thoughts that will condemn them. Though those corruptions do not break out in any scandalous way, these thoughts are in evidence of a rotten heart. Titus 3:3. We ourselves were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. If a man allows himself, though his conscience disallows it, yet if his heart allows it, he is no saint. Some make pretenses to godliness, whereby they do not only deceive others, but, which is a great deal worse, deceive themselves also. But this will condemn them, that they live in a course of sin, and so must go with ungodly men. Psalm 125:5. As for such as turn aside unto their crooked ways, the Lord will lead them forth with the workers of iniquity. If there be a great change in a man's carriage, and he be reformed in several particulars, yet if there be one evil way, the man is an ungodly man. Where there is piety, there is universal obedience. A man may have great infirmities, yet be a godly man. So it is with Lot, David, and Peter. But if he lives in a way of sin, he does not only render his godliness suspicious, but it is full of evidence against him. Men that are godly have respect to all God's commandments, Psalm 119:6. There be a great many commands, and if there be one of them that a man has not respect to, he will be put to shame on another day. If a man lives in one evil way, he is not subject to God's authority, but then he lives in rebellion, and that will take off all his pleas, and at once cut off all his pretenses, and he will be condemned in the day of judgment. One way of sin is exception enough against a man's salvation, though the sin that he lives in be but small. Such persons will not be guilty of perjury, stealing, drunkenness, fornication. They look upon them to be heinous things, as they are afraid of them, but they do not much matter it if they oppress a little in a bargain, if they commend a thing too much when they are about to sell it, if they break a promise, if they spend the Sabbath unprofitably, if they neglect secret prayer, if they talk rudely and reproach others. They think these are but small things. If they can keep clear of great transgressions, they hope that God will not insist upon small things. But indeed all the commands of God are established by divine authority. A small shot may kill a man as well as a cannon bullet. A small leak may sink a ship. If a man lives in small sins, that shows he has no love to God, no sincere care to please and honor God. Little sins are of a damning nature as well as great. If they do not deserve so much punishment as greater, yet they do deserve damnation. There is contempt of God in all sins, Matthew 5:19. He that shall break one of the least of these commands, and shall teach men so, shall be called the least in the kingdom of God. If a man says, this is a great command, and so lays weight on it, and another is a little commandment, and so does not regard it, but will allow himself to break it, he is in a perishing condition, in quote, Stoddard's way to know sincerity and hypocrisy. Number 5. Hardness of heart, so frequently mentioned and complained of in the Scripture, is another evidence of the dominion of sin. But because there are various degrees also of it, they must be considered, that we may judge aright what of it is an evidence of that dominion, and what may be consistent with the rule of grace. For it is that mysterious evil in which the best men do most complain, and whereof the worst have no sense at all. Chapter 4. Hardness of heart spoken to is an imminent sign of sin's dominion, and it is shown that it ought to be considered as total or partial. Hardness of heart is either total and absolute, or partial and comparative only. Total hardness is either natural and universal, or judiciary in some particular individuals. Natural hardness is the blindness or obstinacy of the heart in sin by nature, which is not to be cured by the use or application of any outward means. Hardness and impenitent heart, Romans 2:5. This is that heart of stone which God promises in the covenant to take away by the efficacy of His almighty grace, Ezekiel 36:26. Where this hardness abides uncured, unremoved, their sin is absolute in the throne. This, therefore, we do not inquire about. Judiciary hardness is either immediately from God, or it is by the devil through his permission. In the first way, God has frequently said to harden the hearts of men in their sins and to their ruin, as he did with Pharaoh, Exodus 4:21. And he does it in general two ways. Number one, by withholding from them those supplies of light, wisdom, and understanding, without which they cannot understand their condition, see their danger, or avoid their ruin. Number two, by withholding the efficacy of the means which they enjoy for their conviction and repentance, yea, and giving them as an efficacy to their obduration. Isaiah 6, 9, and 10, by the obduration, Owen means hardening of the heart. And concerning this divine induration, we may observe first that it is the severest of divine punishments in this world, that therefore it is not executed but towards those that are habitually wicked, and so do of choice harden themselves in their sins. Romans 1, 26 and 28. Number three, for the most part it respects some special times and seasons in which are the turning points for eternity. Number four, that the condition of those so hardened is remediless and their wounds incurable. Where any are thus hardened, there is no question about the dominion of sin. Such a heart as its throne, its proper seat next to hell. Secondly, there is a judiciary hardness which Satan, through God's permission, brings on men. 2 Corinthians 4:4. And there are many ways in which he doth affect it, not here to be insisted on. But there is a hardness of heart that is indeed but partial and comparative, whatever appearance it may make of that which is total and absolute, whence the inquiry arises whether it be an evidence of the dominion of sin or not. There is a hardness of heart which is known and lamented by them in whom it is. Hereof the church complains in Isaiah 63:17, O Lord, why hast thou hardened our heart from thy fear, or suffered it so to be, not healing, not recovering our hardness? And there are a number of things which concur in this kind of hardness of heart. Is number one, a lack of readiness to receive divine impressions from the Word of God. When the heart is soft and tender, it is also humble and contrite and ready to tremble at the Word of God. So it is said of Josiah that his heart was tender and he humbled himself before the Lord when he heard his word. 2 Kings 22:18 and 19. This may be lacking in some in a great measure, and they be sensible of it. They may find in themselves a great unreadiness to comply with divine warnings, reproofs, and calls. They are not affected with the word preached, but sometimes complain that they sit under it like stocks and stones. They have not an experience of its power, and are not cast into the mold of it. Hereon they apprehend that their hearts are hardened from the fear of God, as the church complains. There is indeed no better frame of heart to be attained in this life than that in which it is to the word as a wax to the seal, fit and ready to receive impressions from it, a frame that is tender to receive the communications of the Word in all their variety, whether for reproof, instruction, or consolation, and the lack hereof is the culpable hardness of heart. Number two, there belongs to it an unaffectedness with the guilt of sin as to the sorrow and repentance that it doth require. There is none in whom there is any spark of saving grace, but hath a gracious sorrow for sin in some degree or other. But there is a proportion required between sin and sorrow. Great sins require great sorrows, as Peter, on his great sin, wept bitterly. On especial aggravations of sin, requiring a special sense of them. This the soul finds not in itself. It bears the thoughts of sin and the rebukes of conscience without any great concussion or remorse. It can pass over the charge of sin without relenting, mourning, dissolving in sighs and tears, and it cannot but say sometimes thereon that his heart is like the adamant or the flint in the rock. This makes many fear that they are under the dominion of sin, and they fear it the more because that fear does not affect and humble them as it ought. And it must be granted that all unaffectedness with sin, all lack of humiliation and godly sorrow upon it, is from an undue hardness of heart. They who are not affected with it have great reason to be jealous over themselves, even as to their spiritual state and condition. Number three, of the same kind in its measure is unaffectedness with the sins of others among whom we live or in whom we are concerned. To mourn for the sins of others is a duty highly approved of God, Ezekiel 4:4. It argues the effectual working of many graces, the zeal for the glory of God, compassion for the souls of men, love to the glory and interest of Christ in the world. The lack hereof is from hardness of heart, and it is that which abounds among us. Some find not themselves at all concerned herein. Some make pretenses why they need not so be, or that it is not their duty. What is it unto them how wicked the world is? It shall answer for its own sins. nor are they moved when it comes nearer them. If their children come to losses, poverty, ruin, then they are affected indeed, but so long as they flourish in the world, be they apostates from profession, be they enemies to Christ, do they avowedly belong to the world and walk in the ways of it, they are not much concerned, especially if they are not scandalously profligate. But this also is from hardness of heart, which will be bewailed where grace is vigilant and active. Number 4, want of a due sense of indications of divine displeasure is another instance of this hardness of heart. God oftentimes gives signs and tokens of it, whether it's to public state of the church in the world or as to our own persons and afflictions and chastisements. In the seasons of this, he expects that our hearts should be soft and tender, ready to receive impressions of his anger, and pliable in them to his mind and will. There are none whom at such a time he does more abhor than those who are stout-hearted, little regarding him or the operation of his hands. This in some measure may be in believers, and they may be sensible of it, to their sorrow and humiliation. These things, and many more of the like nature, proceed from hardness of heart, or the remainder of our hardness by nature, and are great promoters of the interest of sin in us. But where any persons are sensible of this frame, where they are humbled for it, where they mourn under and cry out for its removal, it is so far from being an evidence of the dominion of sin over them in whom it is, that it is an imminent sign of the contrary, namely, that the ruling power of sin is certainly broken and destroyed in the soul. But there are other instances of hardness of heart which have much more difficulty in them, and which are hardly reconcilable to the rule of grace. I shall mention some of them. First, security and senselessness under the guilt of great actual sins. I do not say this is or can at any time be absolute in any believer, but such it may be as whereon men may go on in their old pace of duties and profession, though without any peculiar humiliation, albeit they are under the provoking guilt of some known sin with its aggravation. It will recur upon their minds and conscience unless it be seared. We'll treat with them about it, but they pass it over as that which they had rather forget and were out of their penitence. So it seems to have been with David after his sin with Bathsheba. I doubt not, but that before the message of God to him by Nathan, he had unpleasing thoughts of what he had done, but there are not the least footsteps in the story or any of his prayers that he laid it seriously to heart and was humbled for it before. This is a great hardness of heart, and we know how difficult his recovery from it was. He was saved, but as through fire. And where it is so with any that has been overtaken with any great sin, as drunkenness or other folly, that he strives to wear it out, to pass it over, to forget it, or give himself countenance from any reasoning or consideration against a special sense of it, and humiliation for it, he can, during that state and frame, have no solid evidence that sin has not the dominion in him. And let such sinners be warned who have so passed over former sins until they have utterly lost all sense of them, or are under such a frame at present, that they recall things to another account, and suffer no such sin to pass without a peculiar humiliation, whatever be the final issue of things with them, they can have no solid ground of spiritual peace in this world. Secondly, there is such a dangerous hardness of heart where the guilt of one sin makes not the soul watchful against another of another sort. Wherever the heart is tender, upon a surprisal into sin, it will not only watch against the returns of it or relapses into it, but will be made diligent, heedful, and careful against all other sins whatever. So is it with all that walk humbly under a sense of sin. But when men are in such a state, they are careless, bold, and negligent, so that as that if they repeat not the same sin, they are easily hurried into others. Thus it was with Esau. He was wroth with a seer that came unto him with a divine message and smote him and put him in a prison house, for he was in a rage. 2 Chronicles 16:10. A man would think that when he was recovered out of this distemper, it might have made him humble and watchful against other sins. But it was not so, for it is added that he oppressed some of the people at the same time. And he rested not there, but in his disease he sought not to the Lord, but to the physicians. Verse 12. Unto persecution he added oppression, and unto that unbelief. Yet notwithstanding all this, Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days, 1 Kings 15:14. That is, he had a prevalent sincerity in him, notwithstanding this these miscarriages, but he was doubtless under the power of great hardness of heart. So is it with others in the like cases. When one sin makes them not careful and watchful against another, as when men abstain themselves with intemperance of life, they may fall into excess of passion with their families and relations, or into a neglect of duty, or take any other crooked steps in their walk. This argues a great prevalency of sin in the soul, although, as we see in the example of Esau, it is not an infallible evidence of its dominion. Yet of that nature it is wherewith divine peace and consolation are inconsistent. Thirdly, when men fall into such unspiritual frames, such deadness and decays as from which they are not recoverable by the ordinary means of grace, it is a certain evidence of hardness of heart and the prevalency of sin therein. It is so, whether this be the fault of churches or of particular persons. The preaching of the word is the special defined ordinance for the healing and recovering of backsliders in heart or life. Where this will not effect it in any, but they will go on forwardly in the ways of their own hearts, unless God takes some extraordinary course with them, they are on the brink of ruin, and live on sovereign grace alone. Thus was it with David. After his great sin, there is no doubt but he attended to all ordinances of divine worship, which are the ordinary means of the preservation and recovery of sinners from their backslidings. Howbeit they had not this effect upon him. He lived impenitently in his sin until God was pleased to use extraordinary means in the special message of Nathan and the death of his child for his awakening and recovery. And thus God will deal sometimes with churches and persons where ordinary means for their recovery will not effect it. He will, by sovereign grace, and it may be by a concurrence of extraordinary providences, heal, revive, and save them. So he promises to do. Isaiah 57:16-19. But where this is trusted to, in the neglect of the ordinary means of healing, seeing there is no direct promise of it, but it is a case reserved to absolute sovereignty, the end may be bitterness and sorrow. And let them take heed who are under this frame, for although God may deliver them, yet it will be by terrible things, as Psalm 65:5. Such terrible things as wherein he will take vengeance on their inventions. Psalm 98:8, though he do forgive them. So David affirms of himself that God in his dealing with him had broken all his bones. Psalm 51:8. I fear this is the present case of many churches and professors at this day. It is evident that they are fallen under many spiritual decays, neither have the ordinary means of grace, repentance, and humiliation, though backed with various providential warnings, been efficacious to their recovery. It is greatly to be feared that God will use some severe dispensation and terrible things towards them for their awakening, or, which is more dreadful, withdraw his presence from them. Fourthly, of the same nature it is, and argues no small power of this evil, when men satisfy and please themselves in an unmortified, unfruitful profession, a severe symptom of the dominion of sin. And there are three things that manifest the consistency of such a profession with hardness of heart, or are fruits of it therein. Number one, a neglect of the principal duties of it. Such are mortification in themselves and usefulness or fruitfulness towards others. A deficiency in neglecting these things are evident amongst many that profess religion. It does not appear that in anything they seriously endeavor the mortification of their lusts, their pride, their passion, their love of the world, their inordinate desires and sensual appetites. They either indulge unto them all, or at least they maintain not a constant conflict against them. And as to usefulness and the fruits of righteousness, which are to the praise of God by Jesus Christ, or those good works which are the evidence of a living faith, they are openly bearing in them. Now, whereas these are the principal dictates of that religion which they do profess, their neglect of them, their deficiency in them, proceed from a hardness of heart, overpowering their light and convictions. And what shall long in such a case stop sin out of the throne? Self-pleasing and satisfaction in such a profession argues a very dangerous state and habit of mind. Sin may have a full dominion under such a profession. Number two, the admission of an habitual formality into the performance of religious duties is of the same nature. In some, the power of sin, as we observed before, prevails to the neglect and omission of such duties. Others continue the observation of them, but are so formal and lifeless in them, so careless as to the exerting or exercise of grace in them, as gives an uncontrollable evidence of the power of sin, and a spiritual senselessness of heart. There is nothing that the Scripture doth more frequently and severely condemn and give as a character of hypocrites than a diligent attendance to a multiplication of duties while the heart is not spiritually engaged in them. For this cause the Lord Christ threatened the utter rejection of the lukewarm church of Laodicea, and God pronounces the most severe sentence against all that are guilty of it, Isaiah 29:13-14. Yet thus it may be with many, and that thus it has been with them, many do manifest by their open apostasy, which is a common event of this frame and course long continued in, for some in a daily performance of religious duties, for a season to exercise and preserve their gifts, but there being no exercise of grace in them, after a while those gifts also wither and decay. They are under the power of the evil in which we treat, namely a hard and senseless heart that can approve of themselves in such a lifeless, heartless profession of religion and performance of the duties thereof. Thirdly, when men grow senseless under the dispensation of the word and do not at all profit by it, the general ends of preaching the word to believers are, number one, the increase of spiritual light, knowledge, and understanding in them, the growth of grace enabling to obedience. Number three, holy excitation of grace by impressions of its power in the communication of the mind, will, love, and grace of God to our souls, which is attended with, number four, an impression on the affections, renewing and making them more holy and heavenly continually. With five, direction and administration of spiritual strength against temptations and corruptions. And six, fruitfulness in the works and duties of obedience. Where men can abide under the dispensation of the word without any of these effects on their minds, consciences, or lives, they are greatly hardened by the deceitfulness of sin, as in Hebrews 3:12-13. This case is stated. Now whether this be from, number one, that carelessness and security which is grown on all sorts of persons against which God does justly express his indignation, by withholding the power and efficacy of his word in its administration from them, or two, from an increase of an unsanctified light and gifts which fill men with high thoughts of themselves and keep them off from that humble frame which alone is teachable, or number three, from a loss of all due reverence to the ministry as God's ordinance for all the ends of the word, with a secret fortification of conscience by prejudices against its power from the suggestions of Satan, or four, from the love of sin which the heart would shelter and secure from the efficacy of the word, or from what other cause soever it be, it proceeds from a dangerous hardness of heart from the power of sin. Where this is the state of the minds of men, where this hardness is thus prevalent in them, I do not, no man can, give them assurance that sin is not dominion in them. But because all these things are capable of various degrees, it may not be concluded absolutely from any or all of them in any degree that so it is. But this we may safely conclude, first, that it is impossible for any man in whom this evil frame is found in any degree, and not sincerely endeavored against, to keep any true solid peace with God or in his soul. What seems to be so in him is but a ruinous security. Secondly, that this is the high road to final obduration and impenitency. And therefore, thirdly, it is the present duty of those who have any care of their souls to shake themselves out of this dust and not to give themselves any rest until they are entered into the paths of recovery. The calls of God to such backsliders in heart for a return are multiplied. The reasons for it and motives to it are innumerable. This ought never to depart from their minds, that without it they shall eternally perish, and they know not how soon they may be overtaken with that destruction. Thus far we have proceeded in the inquiry whether sin has a dominion in us or not. There are on the other side many evidences of the rule of grace sufficient to discard the pleas and pretenses of sin to the throne, but the consideration of them is not my present design. I have only examined the pleas of sin which render the inquiry difficult and the case dubious, and they arise all from the actings of sin in us as it fights against the soul, which is its proper and constant work. 1 Peter 2:11. It does so against the design of the law which is to live to God, against the order and peace of it which it disturbs, and against its eternal blessedness which it would deprive it of. The examination of the pretenses insisted on may be of some use to them that are sincere. But on the other hand, there are uncontrollable evidences of the dominion of sin in men, some in which I shall mention, and only mention, because they need neither proof nor illustration. First, it is so where sin has possessed the will, and it has possessed the will when there are no restraints from sinning taken from its nature, but from its consequence only. Number two, when men proclaim their sins and hide them not, when they boast in them and of them, as it is with multitudes, or number three, approve of themselves in any known sin without renewed repentance, as drunkenness, uncleanness, swearing, and the like. Number four, live in the neglect of religious duties in their closets and families, whence all their public attendance to them is but hypocrisy. Or number five, have an enmity to true holiness and the power of godliness. Or six, are visible apostates from profession, especially if they add, as is usual, persecution to their apostasy. Or seven, are ignorant of the sanctifying principles of the gospel and Christian religion. Or eight, are despisers of the means of conversion. Or nine, live in security under open providential warnings and calls to repentance. Or ten, are enemies in their minds to the true interest of Christ in the world. Where these things are, the like are found. There is no question what it is that has dominion and bears rule in the minds of men. This all men may easily know, as the Apostle declares in Romans 6:16. Chapter 5. The third inquiry handled, namely, what is the assurance given us, and what are the grounds of it, that sin shall not have dominion over us? The ground of this assurance is that we are not under the law, but under grace. The force of this reason shown, namely, how the law does not destroy the dominion of sin, and how grace dethrones sin and gives dominion over it. Section 3. And thus much has been spoken unto the second thing proposed at the entrance of this discourse, namely an inquiry, whether sin have the dominion in any of us or not. I proceed to that which offers itself from the words in the third place, what is the assurance given us, and what are the grounds of it that sin shall not have dominion over us, which lies in this, that we are not under the law but under grace. Where men are engaged in a constant conflict against sin, where they look upon it and judge it their chiefest enemy, which contends with them for their souls and their eternal ruin, where they have experience of its power and deceit, and through the efficacy of them have been often shaken in their peace and comfort, where they have been ready to despond and say they shall one day perish under their powers, it is the gospel word, a word of good tidings that gives them assurance that it shall never have dominion over them. The ground of this assurance is that believers are not under the law, but under grace. And the force of this reason we may manifest in some few instances. First, the law gives no strength against sin to them that are under it, but grace doth. Sin will neither be cast nor kept out of its throne, but by a spiritual power and strength in the soul to oppose, conquer, and dethrone it. Where it is not conquered, it will reign, and conquered it will not be without a mighty prevailing power. This the law will not, cannot give. The law is taken two ways. Number one, for the whole revelation of the mind and will of God in the Old Testament. In this sense, it had grace in it, and so it did give both life and light and strength against sin, as the psalmist declares in Psalm 19:7-9. In this sense, it contained not only the law of precepts, but the promise also in the covenant, which is a means of conveying spiritual life and strength to the church. In this sense, it is not here spoken of, nor is anywhere opposed to grace. Number two, for the covenant rule of perfect obedience, do this and live. In this sense, men are said to be under it in opposition to being under grace. They are under its power, rule, conditions, and authority as a covenant. And in this sense, all men are under it who are not instated in the new covenant through faith in Christ Jesus, who sets up in them and over them the rule of grace. For all men must be one way or other under the rule of God, and he rules only by the law or by grace, and none can be under both at the same time. In this sense, the law was never ordained of God to convey grace or spiritual strength to the souls of men. Had it been so, the promise in the gospel had been needless. If there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law, Galatians 3:21. If it could have given life or strength, it would have produced righteousness. We should have been justified by it. It discovers sin and condemns it, but gives no strength to oppose it. It is not God's ordinance for the dethroning of sin, nor for the destruction of its dominion. This law falls under a double consideration, but in neither of them was designed to give power or strength against sin. Number one. As it was given to mankind in the state of innocency, and it did then absolutely and exactly declare the whole duty of man, whatever God in his wisdom and holiness did require of us. It was God's ruling of man according to the principle of the righteousness in which he was created. But it gave no new aids against sin, nor was there any need that it should do so. It was not the ordinance of God to administer new or more grace to man, but to rule and govern him according to what he had received, and this it continues to do forever. It claims and continues a rule over all men according to what they had and what they have, but it never had power to bar the entrance of sin, nor to cast it out when it was once enthroned. Number two. As it was renewed and enjoined to the Church of Israel on Mount Sinai, and with them, to all that would join themselves to the Lord out of the nations of the world. Yet neither was it then, nor as such designed to, any such end as to destroy or dethrone sin by administration of spiritual strength and grace. It had some new ends given then to it, which it did not in its original constitution. The principle of it was to drive men to the promise in Christ therein, and this it does by all the acts and powers of it on the souls of men. As it discovers sin, as it irritates and provokes it by its severity, as it judges and condemns it, as it denounces a curse on sinners, it drives to the sin, for this was added of grace in the renovation of it. This new end was given to it. In itself it has nothing to do with sinners, but to judge, curse, and condemn them. There is, therefore, no help to be expected against the dominion of sin from the law. It was never ordained of God to that end, nor does it contain, nor is it communicative of, the grace necessary to that end, Romans 8:3. Therefore, those who are under the law are under the dominion of sin. The law is holy, but it cannot make them holy who have made themselves unholy. It is just, but it cannot make them so. It cannot justify them whom it doth condemn. It is good, but can do them no good as to their deliverance from the power of sin. God has not appointed it to that end. Sin will never be dethroned by it. It will not give place to the law, neither in its title nor its power. Those who are under the law will at some seasons endeavor to shake off the yoke of sin and resolve to be no longer under its power, is number one. When the law presses on their consciences, perplexing and disquieting them, the commandment comes home to them, sin revives, and they die. Romans 7:9-10. That is, it gives power to sin to slay the hopes of the sinner and to distress him with the apprehension of guilt and death. For the strength of sin is the law. 1 Corinthians 15:56. The power it has to disquiet and condemn sinners is in and by the law. When it is thus with sinners, when the law presses them with a sense of the guilt of sin and deprives them of all rest and peace in their minds, they will resolve to cast off the yoke of sin, to relinquish its service, that they may be freed from the urgency of the law in their consciences, and they will endeavor it in some instances of duty and abstinence from sin. Number two. They will do the same under surprisals with sickness, pain, dangers, or death itself. Then they will cry and pray and promise to reform and set about it as they suppose in good earnest. This case is fully exemplified in Psalm 78:34-37, and it is manifest in daily experience amongst the multitudes. There are few who are so seared and profligate, but at such seasons they will think of returning to God, of relinquishing the service of sin, and vindicating themselves from under its dominion. And in some, it works a lasting change, though no real conversion doth ensue. But with the most, this goodness is as a morning cloud, and as the early dew it goes away. Number three. The same effect is produced in many by the preaching of the word. Some arrow of conviction is fastened in their minds, in which their former ways displease them, and they judge it is better for them to change the course of their lives and to relinquish the service of sin. These resolutions for the most part abide with them according to the society which they have or fall into. Good society may much help them in their resolves for a time, when by that which is evil and corrupt they are presently extinguished. Number four. Sometimes merciful, enduring providences will have the same effects on the minds of men not obdurate in sin. Such are deliverances from imminent dangers, varying the lives of near relations and the like. In such seasons, men under the law will attend to their convictions and endeavor for a while to shake off the yoke of sin. They will attend to what the law says, under whose power they are, and endeavor a compliance therewith. Many duties shall be performed, and many evils abstained from, in order to the quitting themselves of sin's dominion. But alas, the law cannot enable them to do this. It cannot give them life and strength to go through with what their convictions press them to. Therefore, after a while, they begin to faint and wax weary in their progress, and at length give quite over. It may be they may break off from some great sins in particular, but shake off the whole dominion of sin they cannot. It is otherwise with them that are under grace. Sin shall not have dominion over them. Strength shall be administered to them to dethrone it. Grace is a word of various acceptations in the Scripture. As we are here said to be under it, and as it is opposed to the law, it is used or taken for the gospel, as it is the instrument of God for the communication of Himself, and is grace by Jesus Christ to those that do believe, with that state of acceptation with Himself which they are brought into by it. Romans 5:1-2. Therefore, to be under grace is to have an interest in the gospel covenant and state, with a right to all the privileges and benefits of it. To be brought under the administration of grace by Jesus Christ, to be a true believer. But the inquiry hereon is how it follows from hence that sin shall not have dominion over us, that sin cannot extend its territories and rule into that state, and in what sense this is affirmed. Number one, is it that there shall be no sin in them any more? Even this is true in some sense. Sin, as to its condemning power, has no place in this state. Romans 8:1. All the sins of them that believe are expiated or done away as to the guilt of them in the blood of Christ. Hebrews 1:3, 1 John 1:7. This branch of the dominion of sin, which consists in its condemning power, is utterly cast out of this state. But sin, as to its being and operation, does still continue in believers while they are in this world. They are sensible of it. Those who deceive themselves with a contrary apprehension are most of all under the power of it. 1 John 1:8. Therefore, to be freed from the dominion of sin is not to be freed absolutely from all sin, so as that it should in no sense abide in us any more. This is not to be under grace, but to be in glory. Number two. Is it that sin, though it abides, yet it shall not fight or contend for dominion in us? That this is otherwise we have before declared. Scripture and the universal experience of all that believe do testify the contrary. So does the assurance here given us that it shall not obtain that dominion. For if it did not contend for it, there could be no grace in this promise. There is none in deliverance from that in which we are in no danger. But the assurance here given is built on no other considerations. Therefore, the first is that the gospel is a means ordained and instrument used by God for the communication of spiritual strength to them that believe, for the dethroning of sin. It is the power of God to salvation, Romans 1:16, that in which and in where He puts forth His power to that end. And sin must be really dethroned by the powerful acting of grace in us, and that in a way of duty in ourselves. We are absolved, quitted, freed from the rule of sin as to its pretended right and title by the promise of the gospel. For by this are we freed and discharged from the rule of the law in which all the title of sin to dominion is founded, for the strength of sin is the law. But we are freed from it as to its grace and strength and astute exercise. Now this is communicated by the gospel. It gives life and power with such continual supplies of grace as are able to dethrone sin and forever to prohibit its return. This, then, is the present case supported and determined by the apostle. You that are believers are all of you conflicting with sin. You find it always restless and disquieting, sometimes strong and powerful. When it is in conjunction with any urgent temptation, you are afraid it will utterly prevail over you to the ruin of your souls. Hence you are wearied with it, groan under it and cry out for deliverance from it. All these things the apostle at large insists on in this and the next chapter. But now he says, be of good comfort, notwithstanding all these things and all your fears upon them, sin shall not prevail, it shall not have the dominion, it shall never ruin your souls. But what ground have we for this hope? What assurance of this success? This you have, the apostle says, you are not under the law, but under grace, or the rule of the grace of God in Christ Jesus administered in the gospel. But how does this give relief? Why, it is the ordinance, the instrument of God, which he will use to this end, namely the communication of such supplies of grace and spiritual strength, it shall internally defeat the dominion of sin. This is one principal difference between the law and the gospel, and was ever so esteemed in the church of God until all communication of efficacious grace began to be called in question. The law guides, directs, commands all things that are against the interest and rule of sin. It judges and condemns both the things that promote it and the persons that do them. It frightens and terrifies the consciences of those who are under its dominion. But if you shall say to it, what then shall we do? This tyrant, this enemy is too hard for us. What aid and assistance against it will you afford to us? What power will you communicate to its destruction? Here the law is utterly silent, or says that nothing of this nature is committed to it of God, nay, the strength it has it gives to sin for the condemnation of the sinner. The strength of sin is the law. But the gospel, or the grace of it, is a means and instrument of God for the communication of internal spiritual strength to believers. By it do they receive supplies of the Spirit, or aids of grace for the subduing of sin and the destruction of its dominion. By it they may say they can do all things through him that enables them. Hereon then depends, in the first place, the assurance of the apostle's assertion that sin shall not have dominion over us because we are under grace. We are in such a state as wherein we have supplies and readiness to defeat all the attempts of sin for rule and dominion in us. But some may say, upon this, they greatly fear they are not in this state, for they do not find such supplies of spiritual strength and grace as to give them a conquest over sin. They are still perplexed with it, and it is ready to invade the throne in their minds if it be not already possessed of it. Therefore they fear lest they are strangers from the grace of the gospel. In answer to the things ensuing are proposed. Number 1. Remember what has been declared concerning the dominion of sin. If it be not known what it is and in what it does consist, as some may please themselves while their condition is deplorable, as it is with the most, so others may be perplexed in their minds without just cause. A clear distinction between the rebellion of sin and the dominion of sin is a great advantage to spiritual peace. Number 2. Consider the end for which aids of grace are granted and communicated by the gospel. Now this is not that sin may at once be utterly destroyed and consumed in us, that it should have no being, motion, or power in us any more. This work is reserved for glory in the full redemption of body and soul, which we here do but groan after. But is given to us for this end, that sin may be so crucified and mortified in us, that is, so gradually weakened and destroyed, is that it shall not ruin spiritual life in us, or obstruct its necessary actings and duties and for prevalency against such sins, and would disannul the covenant relation between God and our souls. While we have supplies of it which are sufficient to this end, although our conflict with sin does continue, although we are perplexed by it, yet we are under grace, and sin shall have no more dominion over us. This is enough for us, that sin shall be gradually destroyed, and we shall have a sufficiency of grace on all occasions to prevent its ruling prevalency. Number 3. Live in the faith of this sacred truth, and ever keep alive in your souls expectation of supplies of grace suitable unto it. It is of the nature of true and saving faith, inseparable from it, to believe that the gospel is a way of God's administration of grace for the ruin of sin. He that believes it not, believes not the gospel itself, which is the power of God unto salvation. Romans 1:16. If we live and walk and act as if we had nothing to trust unto but ourselves, our own endeavors, our own resolutions, and that in our perplexities and surprises, it is no wonder if we are not sensible of supplies of divine grace. Most probably we are under the law and not under grace. This is the fundamental principle of the gospel state, that we live in expectation of continual communications of life, grace, and strength from Jesus Christ, who is our life, and from whose fullness we receive in grace for grace. We may therefore, in this case, continually expostulate with our souls, as David doth. Why go you mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? Why are you cast down? And why are you disquieted within us? Still hope in God, he is the health of my countenance. We may be sensible of great oppression from the power of this enemy. This may cause us to go mourning all the day long, and in some sense it ought so to do. Howbeit, we ought not hence to despond or to be cast down from our duty or our comfort. Still, we may trust in God through Christ and live in continual expectation of spiritual releases shall assuredly preserve us from the dominion of sin. This faith, hope, and expectation we are called to by the gospel, and when they are not cherished, when they are not kept unto a due exercise, all things will go backward in our spiritual condition. Number 4, make special application to the Lord Christ, to whom the administration of all spiritual supplies is committed, for the communication of them to you, according to all special occasions. His sin got the advantage of a powerful temptation, so as that it seems to put hard for dominion in the soul, as it was with Paul under the buffetings of Satan, when he had that answer from the Lord upon his reiterated prayer, "My grace is sufficient for thee. Sin shall not have dominion over thee." Has it, by its deceitfulness, brought the soul into a lifeless, senseless frame, made it forgetful of duties, negligent in them, or without spiritual delight in their performance? Has it almost habituated the soul to careless and corrupt inclinations, to the love of or conformity to the world? Does it take advantage from our darkness and confusion under troubles, distresses, or temptations? On these and the like occasions, it is required that we make special fervent application to the Lord Christ for such supplies of grace as may be sufficient and efficacious to control the power of sin in them all. This under the consideration of his office and authority, to this end, his grace and readiness from special inducements we are directed to, Hebrews 4:14-16. Number 5. Remember always the way and method of the operation of divine grace and spiritual aids. It is true, in our first conversion to God, we are, as it were, surprised by a mighty act of sovereign grace, changing our hearts, renewing our minds, and quickening us with the principle of spiritual life. Ordinarily, many things are required of us in a way of duty in order to this, and many previous operations of grace in our minds, in illumination and the sense of sin, do materially and passively dispose us to this, as wood when it is dried is disposed to firing. But the work itself is performed by an immediate act of divine power without any active cooperation on our part. But this is not the law or rule of the communication or operation of actual grace for the subduing of sin. It is given in a way of concurrence with us in the discharge of our duties. And when we are sedulous in them, we may be sure we shall not fail of divine assistance according to the established rule of the administration of gospel grace. If, therefore, we complain that we find not the aids mentioned, and if at the same time we are not diligent in attendance to all the duties in which sin may be mortified in us, we are exceedingly injurious to the grace of God. Therefore, notwithstanding this objection, the truth stands firm that sin shall not have dominion over us, for we are not under the law but under grace. Because of the spiritual aids that are administered by grace for its mortification and destruction. Secondly, the law gives no liberty of any kind, it gendereth to bondage, and so cannot free us from any dominion, not that of sin, for this must be by liberty. But this we have also by the gospel. There is a twofold liberty, number one, of state and condition, number two, of internal operation, and we have both by the gospel. The first consists in our deliverance from the law and its curse, with all things which claim a right against us by virtue of it, that is, Satan, death, and hell. Out of the state From where we can never be delivered by the law, we are translated by grace into a state of glorious liberty. For by it, the Son makes us free. And we receive the liberty of Christ now. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. 2 Corinthians 3:17. This liberty Christ proclaims in the gospel to all that do believe. Isaiah 61:1. On this, they who hear and receive the joyful sound are discharged from all debts, bonds, accounts, rights, and titles, and are brought into a state of perfect freedom. In the state, sin can lay no claim to dominion over any one soul. They are gone over into the kingdom of Christ, and out of from the power of sin, Satan, and darkness. In this, indeed, lies the foundation of our assured freedom from the rule of sin. It cannot make an incursion on the kingdom of Christ so as to carry away any of its subjects into a state of sin and darkness again. And an interest in the state ought to be pleaded against all the attempts of sin, Romans 6:1 and 2. There is nothing more to be detested than that anyone who is Christ's free man and dead to the power of sin should give place again unto any of its pretenses to or endeavors for rule. Again, there is an internal liberty, which is a freedom of the mind from the powerful inward chains of sin, with an ability to act all the powers and faculties of the soul in a gracious manner. And this is the power of sin and the soul destroyed. And this also is given us in the gospel. There is power administered in it to live to God and to walk in all His commandments, and this also gives evidence to the truth of the apostles' assertion. Thirdly, the law does not supply us with effectual motives and encouragements to endeavor the ruin of the dominion of sin in a way of duty, which must be done, or in the end it will prevail. It works only by fear and dread, with threatenings and terrors of destruction, for although it says also do this and live, yet withal it discovers such an impossibility in our nature to comply with its commands and the way and manner in which it enjoins them, that the very promise of it becomes a matter of terror, as including the contrary sentence of death upon our failure in its commands. Now these things innervate, weaken and discourage the soul in its conflict against sin. They give it no life, activity, cheerfulness, or courage in what it undertakes. Hence, those who engage themselves to an opposition to sin or a relinquishment of its service merely on the motives of the law do quickly faint and give over. We see it so with many every day. One day they will forsake all sin, their beloved sin, with the company and occasions inducing them to it. The law has frightened them with divine vengeance, and sometimes they proceed so far in this resolution that they seem escaped from the pollutions of the world. Yet soon again they return to their former ways and follies, 2 Peter 2:22. Their goodness is as a morning cloud, and as the early dew it goes away. Or if they do not return to wallow in the same mire of their former pollutions, they betake themselves to the shades of some superstitious observances, as it is in the papacy. For they openly succeed into the room of the Jews, who being ignorant of the righteousness of God, and not submitting thereunto, went about variously to establish their own righteousness, as the Apostle speaks in Romans 10, 3 and 4. For in that apostate church, where men are wrought on by the terrors of the law to relinquish sin, and set themselves in opposition to its power, finding themselves altogether unable to do it by the works of the law itself, which must be perfectly holy, they betake themselves to a number of superstitious observances, which they trust to in the room of the law, with its commands and duties. But the law makes nothing perfect, nor are the motives it gives for the ruin of the interests of sin in us able to bear us out and carry us through that undertaking. But the motives and encouragements given by grace to endeavor the utter ruin of sin in any way of duty are such as give life, cheerfulness, courage, and perseverance. They continually animate, relieve, and revive the soul in all its work and duty, keeping it from fainting and despondency, for they are all taken from the love of God and of Christ, from the whole work and end of His mediation, from the ready assistances of the Holy Ghost, from all the promises of the gospel, from their own with other believers' experiences, all giving them the highest assurance of final success and victory. When the soul is under the influence of these motives, whatever difficulty and opposition it meets with from soliciting temptations or surprisals, it will renew its strength. It will run and not be weary. It will walk and not faint, according to the promise. Isaiah 40, verse 31. Fourthly, Christ is not in the law. He is not proposed in it, not communicated by it. We are not made partakers of Him by this. This is a work of grace or the gospel. In it is Christ revealed. By it He is proposed and exhibited to us. Thereby are we made partakers of Him and all the benefits of His mediation. And He it is alone who came to and can destroy this work of the devil. The dominion of sin is a complement of the works of the devil where all his designs center. This the Son of God was manifested to destroy. He alone ruins the kingdom of Satan, whose power is acted in the rule of sin. Therefore, unto this our assurance of this comfortable truth is principally resolved, and what Christ has done and does for the sin is a great part of the subject of gospel revelation. The like may be spoken of the communication of the Holy Spirit, which is the only principal efficient cause of the ruin of the dominion of sin. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, and nowhere else. But we receive the Spirit not by the works of the law, but by the hearing of faith. Galatians 2:2. Chapter 6. The practical observations drawn from and the application made of the whole text. Having opened the words and made some improvement of them, I shall now take one or two observations from the design of them and issue the whole in a word of application. Observation 1. It is an unspeakable mercy and privilege to be delivered from the dominion of sin, and such it is here proposed by the apostle, as such it is esteemed by them that believe. Nothing is more sweet, precious, and valuable to a soul conflicting with sin and temptation than to hear that sin shall not have the dominion over it. Ah, what would some give that it might be spoken to them with power, so as that they might steadfastly believe it and have the comfort of it? Fools make a mock of sin, and some glory in the service of it, which is their shame. But those who understand anything aright, either of what is present or what is to come, do know that this freedom from its dominion is an invaluable mercy, and we may consider the grounds which evidence it is so to be. First, it appears so to be from the causes of it. It is that which no man can by his own power and the utmost of his endeavors attain to. Men by them may grow rich or wise or learned, but no man by them can shake off the yoke of sin. If a man had all the wealth of the world, he could not by it purchase this liberty. It would be despised. And when sinners go hence to the place where the rich man was tormented and have nothing more to do with this world, they would give it all, if they had it, for an interest in this liberty. It is that which the law and all the duties of it cannot procure. The law and its duties, we have declared, can never destroy the dominion of sin. All men will find the truth of this that ever come to fall under the power of real conviction. When sin presses on them and they are afraid of its consequence, they will find that the law is weak, and the flesh is weak, and their duties are weak, and their resolutions and vows are weak, all insufficient to relieve them. And if they think themselves freed one day, they shall find the next that they are under bondage. Sin, for all this, will rule over them with force and vigor. And in this condition do some spend all their days in this world. They kindle sparks of their own and walk in the light of them until they lie down in darkness and sorrow. They sin and promise amendment and endeavor recompenses by some duties, yet can never extricate themselves from the yoke of sin. We may therefore learn the excellency of this privilege first from its causes, wherefore I shall mention some only. Number 1. The meritorious procuring cause of this liberty is the death and blood of Jesus Christ. So it is declared in 1 Peter 1:18 and 19 and 1 Corinthians 6:20 and 7:23. Nothing else could purchase this freedom. Under the power and dominion of sin we were and could not be delivered without a ransom. Christ died and rose and revived that he might be our Lord, Romans 14:9, and so deliver us from the power of all other lords whatever. It is true there was no ransom due to sinner Satan, who was the author of it. They were to be dethroned or destroyed by an act of power. Both the devil and sin, which is his work, are to be destroyed, not appeased. Hebrews 2:14, 1 John 3:8. But the strength of sin is a law, 1 Corinthians 15:56. That is, through the righteous sentence of God, we were held by the law obnoxious to the condemning power of sin. From that law we could not be delivered but by this price and ransom. Two things hence follow. Number 1. Those who live in sin, who willingly abide in the service of it, and endure its dominion, do cast the utmost contempt on the wisdom, love, and grace of Christ. They despise that which cost him so dear. They judge that he made a very foolish purchase of this liberty for us with his dearest blood. Whatever it be, they prefer the present satisfaction of their lusts before it. This is a poison of unbelief. There is in it a high contempt of the wisdom and love of Christ. The language of men's hearts that live in sin is that the liberty which he purchased with his blood is not to be valued or esteemed. They flatter him with their lips in the outward performance of some duties, but in their hearts they despise him in the whole work of his mediation. But the time is approaching in which they will learn the difference between the slavery of sin and the liberty in which Christ makes believers free. And this is that which is now tendered to sinners in the dispensations of the gospel. Life and death are here set before you. Choose life, that you may live forever. Number 2. Let those that are believers in all their conflicts with sin live in the exercise of faith on this purchase of liberty made by the blood of Christ, for two things will hence ensue. First, that they will have a weighty argument always in readiness to oppose unto the deceit and violence of sin. The soul will on this say to itself, shall I forego and part with that which Christ purchased for me at so dear a rate, by giving place to the solicitations of lust or sin? Shall I despise his purchase? God forbid. See Romans 6:2. By such arguings is the mind frequently preserved from closing with the enticements and seductions of sin. Secondly, it is an effectual argument for faith to use in its pleading for deliverance from the power of sin. We ask for nothing but what Christ has purchased for us, and if this plea be pursued, it will be prevalent. Number 2, the internal efficient cause of this liberty, or that in which the power and rule of sin is destroyed in us, is the Holy Spirit himself, which further evinces the greatness of this mercy. Every act for the mortification of sin is no less immediately from him than those positive graces are in which we are sanctified. It is through the Spirit that we mortify the deeds of the body, Romans 8:13. Where he is, there, and there alone, is liberty. All attempts for the mortification of sin without his special aids and operations are frustrate, and this manifests the extent of the dominion of sin in the world. Number 3, the instrumental cause of this freedom is the duty of believers themselves in and for the destruction of sin, and this also manifests the importance of this privilege. This is one of the principal ends of our religious duties, of prayer, of fasting, of meditation, of watchfulness, unto all other duties of obedience. They are all designed to prevent and ruin the interest of sin in us. We are called into a theater to fight and contend, into a field to be tried in our warfare. Our enemy is this sin, which strives and contends for the rule over us. This we are to resist even unto blood, that is, unto our utmost in doing and suffering. And certainly that is in itself and to us of the highest importance, which on divine appointment and command is the great end of the constant endeavors of our whole lives. Secondly, it appears so to be from the consideration of the bondage which we are delivered from by it. Bondage is that which human nature is most averse from, until it be debased and debauched by sensual lusts. Men of ingenious spirits have in all ages chosen rather to die than to be made slaves. But there is no such bondage as that which is under the dominion of sin. To be under the power of base lusts, as covetousness, uncleanness, drunkenness, ambition, pride, and the like, to make provision to fulfill their desires and the wills of the mind and the flesh, is the worst of slavery. Thirdly, it is so with respect to the end of this bondage, or what it brings men to. If after all the base drudgery which sinful men are put to in the service of their lusts, if after all the conflicts which their consciences put them on with fears and terrors in the world, they could expect anything of a future reward hereafter, something might be spoken to alleviate their present misery. But the wages of sin is death, eternal death, under the wrath of the great God, is all they are to look for. The end of the dominion of sin is to give them up to the curse of the law and power of the devil forevermore. Fourthly, it keeps men off from the participation of all real good here and hereafter. What men under the power of sin do enjoy will quickly appear to be a thing of nothing. In the meantime, they have not the least taste of the love of God, which alone takes out the poison of their enjoyments. They have not the least view of the glory of Christ, without which they live in perpetual darkness, like those who never behold the sun or light. I shall add one observation more, and with it put a close to this discourse. Observation 2. It is the great interest of a soul conflicting with the power of sin to secure itself against its dominion, that it is not under its dominion, not to have the cause hang dubious in the mind. To clear the truth of this, we may observe the things that follow. First, the conflict with sin, making continual repentance and mortification absolutely necessary, will continue in us while we are in this world. Pretenses of perfection here are contrary to the Scriptures, contrary to the universal experience of all believers, and contrary to the sense and conscience of them by whom they are pleaded, as they make it evident every day. We pray against it, strive against it, groan for deliverance from it, and that by the grace of Christ, healing our nature, not without success. Howbeit, this success extends not to its absolute abolition while we are in this world. It will abide in us until the union of the soul and body in which it has incorporated itself be dissolved. This is our lot and portion. This is the consequence of our apostasy from God and of the deprivation of our nature thereby. You will say then, whereto serves the gospel and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ in this case, if it be not able to give us deliverance in it? I answer, it does give us a fourfold relief, which amounts virtually to a constant deliverance, though sin will abide in us while we are in the world. Number one, it is so ordered that the continuance of sin in us shall be the ground, reason, and occasion of the exercise of all grace and of all putting a luster on our obedience. Some excellent graces, as repentance and mortification, could have no exercise if it were otherwise. And while we are in this world, there's a beauty in them that is an overbalance for the evil of the remainders of sin. Number two, there are, by the grace of Christ, such supplies and aids of spiritual strength granted to believers, the sins shall never proceed further in them than is useful and needful for the exercise of their graces. It shall never have its will upon them, nor dominion over them, as we have before declared. Number three, there is mercy administered in and by the gospel for the pardon of all that is evil in itself or in any of its effects. There is no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. Pardoning mercy according to the tenor of the covenant does always disarm the sin in believers of its condemning power, so that notwithstanding the utmost endeavors of it, being justified by faith, they have peace with God. Number four, there is a season when, by the grace of Christ, it shall be utterly abolished, namely at death, when the course of our obedience is finished. Therefore, to affirm that this sin, and consequently a conflict with it, doth abide in believers while they're in the world, is no disparagement to the grace of Christ, which gives such a blessed deliverance from it. Secondly, there's a double conflict with and against sin. The one is in those that are unregenerate, consisting in the rebellion of light and conscience against the rule of sin in many particular instances. For although sin be enthroned in the will and affections, yet the knowledge of good and evil in the mind, excited by the hopes and fears of things eternal, will make head against it as to the performance of a number of duties and abstinence from sin. This conflict may be where sin is in the throne, and may deceive themselves, supposing it to be from the rule of grace, when it is only from the rebellion of light and the charge of a conscience yet unseared. But there is a conflict with sin where grace has a rule and is enthroned. For although grace have the sovereignty in the mind and heart, yet the remainders of sin, especially in the corrupt affections, will be continually rebelling against it. Now this, we say, is the interest of all, namely to inquire what sort and kind that conflict with sin is which is in them. If it be of the first sort, they may yet be under the dominion of sin. If of the latter, they are freed from it. Therefore, while the mind is dubious in this case and undetermined, many evil consequences it will be perplexed with. I shall name some of them. Number one, such a soul can have no solid peace because it has not satisfaction what state it does belong to. Number two, it cannot receive refreshment by gospel consolations in any condition, for its just fears of the dominion of sin will defeat them all. Number three, it will be dead and formal in its duties without spiritual courage and delight, which will at length make it weary of them. So number four, all grace, especially faith, will be weakened and impaired under this frame continually. Number five, fear of death will hold the soul in bondage. Therefore, it is highly necessary to have this case well stated and determined in our minds. Therefore, if the foregoing discourse may contribute anything, it is what was designed in them. There remains only to give some few directions how the prevalency of sin, to such a degree as to render the case about its rule dubious in the mind, may be obviated and prevented. Some few of the many that might be given I shall propose. First, the great rule for preventing the increase and power of vicious habits is watch against beginnings. Sin does not attempt dominion, but in particular instances by one special lust or another. Therefore, if any sin or corrupt lust begin, as it were, to set up for a peculiar predominancy or interest in the mind and affections, if it be not entertained with severe mortification, it will ruin the peace, if not endanger the safety of the soul. And when this is so, it may easily be discovered by anyone who keeps a diligent watch over his heart and ways. For no sin does so entirely advance itself in the mind and affections, but it is promoted therein either by men's natural inclinations, or by their circumstances on occasions of life, or by some temptation which they have exposed themselves to, or by some such neglect in which the frequency of acts has strengthened vicious inclinations. But these things may be easily discerned by those who are in any measure awake to their soul's concerns. The strict charge given us by our Lord Jesus Christ to watch, and that of the wise man, above all keepings to keep our heart, have a special regard to those beginnings of sins obtaining power in us. So soon as the discovery is made of its coincidence or conjunction with any of these ways of the promotion of its power, if it be not opposed with severe and diligent mortification, it will proceed in the method declared, James 1:14-15. Those who would be wise must familiarize wisdom to their minds by a continual free converse with it. They must say unto wisdom, Thou art my sister, and call understanding their kinswoman, Proverbs 7:4. So will wisdom have power in and over their minds. And if we suffer sin by any of the advantages mentioned to familiarize itself to our minds, if we say not to it, get thee hence, upon the first appearance of its activity for power in us, it will put it hard for the throne. Number two, carefully inquire and try whether such things which you may do or approve of in yourselves do not promote the power of sin and help on its rule in you. This method David prescribes in Psalm 19:12-13. Secret sins, such as are not known to be sins, it may be, to ourselves, make way for those that are presumptuous. Thus pride may seem to be nothing but a frame of mind belonging to our wealth and dignity, or our parts and abilities. Sensuality may seem to be but a lawful participation of the good things of this life, passion and peevishness, but a due sense of the lack of that respect which we suppose due to us, covetousness, a necessary care of ourselves and our families. Number three, keep your hearts always tender to the Word. This is the true and only state of inconsistency with and repugnancy to the rule of sin. The loss of this or decay herein is that which has opened the floodgates of sin amongst us. Where this frame is, a conscientious fear of sinning will always prevail in the soul. Where it is lost, men will be bold in all sorts of follies. That this frame may be preserved, it is required, number one, that we cast out all vicious habits of minds that are contrary to it, James 1:21. Number two, that we preserve an experience of its power and efficacy on our souls, 1 Peter 2:1-3. Number three, that we lay aside all prejudices against those that dispense it, Galatians 4:16. Number four, that we keep the heart always humble, in which frame alone it is teachable, Psalm 25:9. Everything in the preaching of the word comes across and unpleasing to the minds of proud men. Number five, that we pray for a blessing on the ministry, which is the best preparation for receiving the benefit of it. Number four, abhor that peace of mind which is consistent with any known sin. Men may have frequent surprisals to known sins, but if while it is so with them, they refuse all inward peace, but what comes in by most fervent and sincere desires of deliverance from them, and repentance for them, they may be saved from the dominion of sin. But if men can, on any hopes or presumptions or resolutions, preserve a kind of peace in their minds while they live in any known sin, they are near the borders of that security which is the territory in which sin doth reign. Number five, Make continual applications to the Lord Christ and all the acts of his mediation for the ruin of sin, especially when it attempts the dominion in you, Hebrews 4:16. This is the life and soul of all directions in this case, which needs not here to be enlarged on. It is frequently spoken to. Lastly, remember the deduced sense of deliverance from the dominion of sin is the most effectual motive to universal obedience and holiness. As such, it is proposed and managed by the Apostle, Romans 6. End of the Discourse of the Dominion of Sin and Grace by Dr. John Owen. Narrated February 2nd, 2007.